County Board of Commissioners regular meeting. It is December 20th, 2016. That's just a minute after 9 o'clock, so we're pretty close. I thank everyone for being here during this holiday season. It's very cold outside, and for everyone to make the effort to come here and be with us this morning is very special, and we appreciate you all being here. So this meeting is hereby called to order. Clerk, call the roll.
Chairman Fembro.
Present.
Commissioner Romero.
Present.
Commissioner Blankenher.
Present.
Commissioner Gago.
Present.
We're going to just pass the Pledge of Allegiance, which is the next item on the agenda. We're honored. Commissioner O'Donnell set up with Ana Kayla Trujillo, who will be sharing a Christmas song with us, and she'll be accompanied by Rose Zicarelli right after the Pledge of Allegiance. So if everyone will please stand. Ana Kayla, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Robbie and Sue Trujillo are blessed to share Michaela with us. She sings the national anthem at many events throughout the state. And Robbie, Sue, we really appreciate you guys for sharing your lovely daughter with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, what a beautiful way to start our commission meetings. And, you know, thank you for blessing us with your voice and also to the guitarist as well.
It needs to be said she actually had to reschedule a final to be here, so good luck on your finals.
God bless you.
We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is approval of the agenda. And first off, commissioners, we need to move item 10E to following, actually, I think where we'll move it to is following citizens' concerns, because this was a public hearing advertised for 9 a.m. this morning regarding an ordinance. However, we will open the public hearing and staff has a recommendation. So it'll be a very short item. So I'm saying move 10E to just before approval of the amendments. And I know Commissioner O'Donnell also has an adjustment as well. Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to amend the agenda to postpone to the last meeting in January 10D. This is a resolution recognizing the value of national public lands to Taos County. The reason I asked for that is the land grant people could not be here today to express why they are against this based on state statute and the New Mexico Constitution. And so I would like to give them the opportunity. They did say they could make it the second meeting in January.
You did see the amended version that was brought forth saying that it had no effect on land grants?
I read it, but I wasn't aware it was in my packet.
It is in your packet. It's just one short whereas at the end of the resolution. Do you want to look at it real quick? And but I had the language added to it that it would not affect, have no effect on my graph.
So can you tell me what page I is in the packets?
Page 148. It's the last whereas it's on that resolution.
It reads as follows: whereas these lands are an outstanding value to surrounding villages, tribal groups, the safety organizations, land grant communities, and nothing in this resolution diminishes their rights.
I'm sorry, Doug.
Okay, well.
All right, Mr. Chairman, I withdraw that. I still think it would be helpful for the land grant.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda with the amendment set forth by the chairman.
I'll go ahead and second that motion, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion and a second to approve the agenda with moving 10E following citizen concerns. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Chairman Fabro?
Yes. All right. Next item is item 5, awards and recognitions. Item A is a presentation awarding Taos County Employee of the Month for December 2016. This will be presented to Leroy Vigil. He's a sergeant at our adult detention center. His family is here with us here today. Mr. Javier and Mr. Rebecca?
Yes. Morning, Chairman, members of the Commission. Stand proudly before you to present our Employee of the Month for December 2016, Adult Detention Center Sergeant Leroy Vigil. I was working in HR when we hired Mr. Vigil, and I always thought back when we hired him that he could have a long career here at Taos County, so I'm kind of proud to see him up here today. Sergeant Vigil is being recognized for his outstanding dedication to the Adult Detention Center. Sergeant Vigil has gone above and beyond the call of duty on several occasions, responding in emergency situations off duty to the facility to help his fellow officers. Sergeant Vigil serves as a role model for many of the new officers at the detention center. Sergeant Vigil has been instrumental in the building and molding of several corporals and sergeants. Sergeant Vigil is such a tremendous asset to the facility. We believe that Sergeant Vigil has proven his dedication and professionalism and valor. He's very humble in his willingness to teach, grow, and mold new officers. It's unheard of here at the county, and it'll be hard pressed to find his equal in the Adult Detention Center. So we'd like to recognize him as Employee of the Month for December 2016. Also entitled to 8 hours of regular pay, and he also received a gift card for Walmart. Thank you, Leroy, and Director Bates, I'll step. Thank you.
And again, you know, I would like to thank Leroy, Sergeant Vigil, because I have been here approximately 7 months. And throughout my 7 months, many times I have met with Sergeant Vigil, and he has brought a lot of valid points to me, and I've taken him with a grain of salt. You know, he's very professional, he's mentored, and he's developed many of his subordinates. And, you know, I do appreciate what Sergeant Vigil stands for. Again, you know, I thank his family for giving us Sergeant Vigil, because he continues to be a big part of this team in Taos County, in Taos County Adult Detention Facility. So, Sergeant Vigil, congratulations, and it's well deserved.
Thank you. I work with and work for, and you guys for giving me the opportunity to work at the detention center. I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you guys again.
They're forgetting one of your best attributes.
Oh.
Your grandpa Frank was one of the best Cubs fan I've
ever. Yeah. Thank you again. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Going up and checking, offering any assistance from the county up there. Appreciate
I mean, you came into just an unbelievable busy time, Bobby, and you handled it well. Thank you.
Thank you. We look forward to moving forward and helping out with the community. Thank you for the opportunity to be in this position.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Rosetto, welcome. And just wondering, what sort of assistance is the county offering at this point?
We've just been helping out with whatever they need. We did help them get some restroom figures that they needed to get the schools going, but unfortunately, they had some issues with the generators that were supplying the water, so they weren't able to use it at this time. We have helped them out with some water buffaloes, as well as getting some donations for water, drinking water, and everything else that we've done. Just try to point them in the right direction and keep the IC operations for the community to try to get everything situated.
Is the county or the village of Cuesta seeking any outside help from other sources like the state?
As of right now, they have to keep track of all the documentation on a day-to-day basis with as far as staffing and equipment to use, stuff like that. And we've been speaking with Donald Matheson from the state, and just as long as everything is up to par with all their paperwork, they will be getting reimbursement. My understanding is they'll have to come up to 25% of theirs on their paper, anything else, the crew cost.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, thank you, Bobby. Okay, next item on the agenda is item 6. This is our citizens' concern period. If anyone wishing to address the commission on an item that is not on the agenda or something that's on the agenda later that you will not be able to be here on, if it's regarding the public hearing that's about to open, please keep your comments for that. But you have 5 minutes or less to address the commission. We thank you for being here today. Anyone wishing to address? Ms. Webb.
Commissioners, we were late getting on the agenda, but I wanted to bring forth to you guys our newest employee. We hired, rounding out our dispatch staff, it's Nina Abreu. She just started with us yesterday, and wanted to bring her up and introduce her to you guys.
You didn't want to scare her away right away, did you?
Well, I tried yesterday.
Thank you.
So,
welcome
to our office.
Thank you very much.
Good luck. It's a great place over there. We're just going to make it better. We appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments from the audience? Mr. Hall.
Ms. Diaz. When I left the town library last night, a few minutes before 6 o'clock, I passed you along. I passed a young woman sitting on what must have been very cold ground near the bicycle rack. She was quietly singing a Christmas carol. Silent night. I had first seen her a few weeks ago around the first of the month on the same occasion, leaving the library at 6 o'clock. She was sitting on the bench near the bicycle rack, bent over with her head near her knees, and trembling visibly in the cold. That's when I first thought to ask if she had someplace to go, but hesitated doing so, thinking she may have been waiting for a ride for someone to pick her up. I left and had been home for about half an hour when I decided I should have asked if she needed help. And so I returned to the library. She wasn't there, and I told myself she was all right. The next time I saw her was last week, and she sat near me in the library. When I left that afternoon, she was engrossed in a mobile device, again sitting on the bench near the bicycle rack. It was still light, the day was comfortably warm in the full sunshine, and she appeared in no distress as I left. Last night she finished singing as I unlocked and prepared to leave on my bicycle. The temperature at the time was around 20 degrees and was forecast to fall into the single digits. The night before, the temperature had slipped below zero. She was no more than a few feet away, and I asked if she had somewhere to go to get in and out of the cold. She said she had a tent, and if I remember correctly, that it was in the woods. I said I believed there was a shelter for women in town and asked her if she knew of it. She said yes, but that she couldn't stay there. When I asked why, she replied she'd been abused and been raped and that her abuser was not in jail. Since her abuser was not in jail, she was told the shelter couldn't invite her in because her presence might have represented a threat to others should her abuser returned, given what I had just been told. I asked if she was aware of the Community Against Violence organization. Again, she said yes, but she had approached them, but they couldn't offer her assistance because the abuse needed to occur in a household, but she was homeless. And those were the circumstances in which the abuse had occurred. I felt completely helpless at that moment. And couldn't possibly imagine how she felt, what she was thinking, or what she was going through. I could only take her words to be true. That had to be my obligation and my responsibility at that moment, and yet I had nothing to offer. No consoling words, if words could even console, given her circumstances, and no suggestion as to what to do. I bicycled away, wondering what to do, knowing nothing other than what I told you. I like to imagine seeing her again and hope to see her again. At that time, I'm not prepared or willing to walk away. On that occasion, please advise me as to what I should say to her, what I might suggest to her in the way of assistance, where might I send her, where she would be welcome, where someone could begin asking the questions necessary to hopefully set her on a more promising path. Local government resolutions and ordinances usually include words to the effect, quote, to ensure the health, safety, and welfare of the public, of the community. It seems to me that she's a member of this community. I don't know where she's from. I know nothing about her. She said she had encountered the same response in Albuquerque and in Santa Fe, if that's the case, or there it indicates that she's wandering. So, do you have any thoughts?
Commissioner Blackman. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Stevens. If you see her again, ask her to go to the men's shelter. We, you know, we serve dinner every night. Women show up there too. It doesn't sound right to me, you know, as far as the Heart of Taos' response. AMA and the Heart of Taos, the women's shelter, it doesn't really.
Again, I didn't pursue it, yeah. And I thought the same thing that you're thinking now. But whatever those circumstances are, it didn't seem to me that was the occasion to begin questions.
Sure. Anyhow, you know, if you do see her again, she could go to the men's shelter for dinner, and once she was there, I think staff would possibly be able to hook her up with AMA and have some direct contact again, so that it could be clarified. And some of the possible misconceptions could be.
All of those thoughts occurred to me last night after I left. So again, I went back about half an hour later, she was gone.
Right.
And I thought, you know, I could go over and to the police department, but there's no way to get in there. The police department, I thought I could have taken her to the sheriff's office. You know, all of these thoughts occurred to me after the occasion. But in that moment, I really didn't know what to do.
I'll talk to AMA. She has people on the streets and let them know to look out for them.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Anyone else wishing to address the commission? Seeing none, we'll move on to item 10E. This is a discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of Ordinance 2016-6 and Ordinance adopting Ordinance 2016-6 related to economic development planning and repealing and replacing Ordinance 26-5. This will be presented by our staff, Edward Vigil, our planning director. This is a public hearing. And is it your thought for me to open the public hearing at this time?
Mr. Chairman, yes.
Okay, this time the public hearing is open. Anyone wishing to talk regarding Ordinance 2016-6, an ordinance adopting the ordinance relating to economic development planning and repealing and replacing previous Ordinance 26-5. If you do wish to address the commission at this time, please state your name for the record.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Mr. Corbett, Ms. Baker, good morning. Merry Christmas to you and your families, and a Happy New Year to you as well. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, this morning I come to before you respectfully to ask you to continue this item. We had a work study, not regarding this item, but we had a work study last week regarding the Taos County Comprehensive Plan. And we had a work study regarding the Taos County Economic Plan, where we basically determined or decided that we would like to put those two items on the agenda of the January 10th, 2017 meeting before you as under a resolution for approval of those proposed plans. In conjunction with the discussion that we had, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, we respectfully request that you continue the public hearing to January 10th and that you all determine as to what time you would like to consider this item on January the 10th. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Are there any other members of the public wishing to address the Commission regarding this matter? Commissioners, before I close the public hearing, do I hear a motion?
So moved, Mr. Chairman, to continue the public hearing to January 10th at a time to be designated right now by somebody.
I have a motion to postpone, to continue this public hearing to a time to be set here today to January 10th, 2017.
I will go in second, Mr. Chairman,
and I have a second.
Mr. Chairman,
how long are we at a time?
I think we should have a time.
And Mr. Chairman, how will we advertise this meeting?
There's no need for a second advertisement if we continue it during the public hearing. Okay.
Should we consider advertising it anyway if there's not a...
We could, but we would need to have the board adopt a resolution to publish. So,
that
for Robert's rules, if we open the public hearing and then continue to a date certain, it serves that purpose of giving notice so that we don't have to publish. But we could, and I could bring a resolution to publish to you on January 10th if you want.
What is staff's recommendation for the time?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, we recognize that January 10th is your first meeting of the new year and it's going to be a busy meeting for you all. If we could look at getting the item early on, we don't anticipate any opposition. We don't anticipate it being a lengthy public hearing. We anticipate it moving along pretty quick. Whatever would be convenient to you, Attorney Baker, recommend possible 9:30, we're comfortable with 9:30 if you'd like.
I actually am thinking more like 10 because we have the election of chairman, we have the Meetings Act resolution that needs to be adopted, and the policy and procedures for meetings if we choose to enact that. That can take some time, so my recommendation would be 10 a.m.
I'll amend my motion to continue the public hearing on this ordinance until January 10th, public hearing to begin at 10 a.m.
A friendly second, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion and a second to amend. We'll vote on the amendment first. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhardt?
Yes.
Chairman Thamber?
Yes. Now we're voting on the motion to amend, to move the continue the public hearing until 10 a.m. on the 10th of January 2017. No further discussion. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhardt?
Yes.
Chairman Thamber?
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is item 7A, discussion, consideration, and decision regarding the approval of the November 22nd, 2016 special meeting minutes, which were pulled from the last meeting. Right, Commissioner O'Donnell, are we ready to proceed?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Do I hear a motion to approve the minutes of the special meeting, which was held on November 22nd, 2016.
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Motion and a second. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhardt?
Yes.
Chairman Thamber?
Yes. Item B is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of the December 6, 2016 regular commission meeting minutes.
Move to approve.
I'll second. I have a motion and a second to approve the December 6, 2016 regular commission meeting minutes. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
I'll abstain. I wasn't at this meeting.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhardt?
Yes.
Chairman Thamber?
Yes. Okay, so we're all caught up. Item 8, presentations. First, item A is a presentation from Tri-County Sue Mulvaney. Hi, Sue.
Hello. Back again. Chairman Thamber and Commissioners, I promised you a year ago that I would keep you informed about any goings on and changes at Tri-County, so that's why I'm here today. At our last board meeting, ask our board to allow me to step down as executive director and move one of our board members into the executive role for Tri-County. I will be moving back to my former position of chief operating officer so that I can lend support to the executive director role. We have a very qualified individual that joined our board several months ago and has been working with me. His name is Dr. Rodney Gross. Dr. Gross has a very extensive hospital administrative background, healthcare background, and he is the person that needs to take our organization from where it is now to the next step. I came in at a time where I needed to kind of stabilize the organization and keep us going, and I feel I've been very successful in doing that, and I'm very excited about being able to move Dr. Gross into that role and to support him as his COO. So I wanted to keep you informed on that and to let you know that we have some new developments at our agency. We have been approved by Genoa Pharmaceuticals to establish an in-house pharmacy, which will be a step towards one-stop shopping for our individuals. So anybody coming in who needs medication and our staff will be able to see our prescriber and move right to our own internal pharmacy and be served. So that should cut down on a lot of non-compliance with our folks. We're also moving into telepsychiatry, which will also expand the capability of Tri-County to be able to provide extended prescriber services for our clients. So I want to thank the commission. You will see me again. I'm not going away. I'll probably be here more than ever, but I wanted to keep you informed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Lankner.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Sue. I really appreciate all the work you did to pull Tri-County out of the ditch and keep it going. We really need Tri-County services here in Taos. So thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks again. Item B is a presentation by the town of Taos. Our mayor, Mr. Dan Barrone, is not wearing the hat he had yesterday because I think he got shot at and had reindeer ears. And I think he dodged a few bullets, but he's getting good at that. He'll be talking about the CDBG update from you, the Medio update, 6468 update, and then economic development or affordable housing slash all that kind of blends together. Morning, Mayor.
Morning. Morning, Chairman Ferry. Morning, Commissioners. Leandro, Madam Attorney, and fellow worker employees. Again, it's great to be back in the building. I see you hired another great employee, Mrs. Abreu there. She had a lot of history with her. I think she's going to be a great employee for the community. I just want to say thank you for getting us on the agenda. We have a lot of capable staff at the town, and they're with me today. And as we go through these agenda items, updates, you know, there's a number of things that the community works well with each other, and as we continue to move forward, one thing affects the other within our community, and we just want to make sure that, you know, we're having those dialogues so that we are updating each other on what's going on with the different aspects in the community. So I'd like to call Linda. She's our grants writer, and she's basically spearheading our CDBG grant and to give us an update on what's going on, how it's moving forward.
Linda. Good morning, Ms. Perry.
Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners, Attorney Baker. I just want to say how lovely it was to kick off this meeting with a song from the young lady singing Christmas Carol. That's just beautiful. Thank you so much for that. So just a quick overview. Most of you have heard this, but we'll just kind of quick overview of the CDBG. The town went into contract with NCA Architects, and the design is complete. A bid for construction was released, and CDR Construction was awarded the project at $610,426. We suspended the project because we did not receive a release of funds, and also that was concurrent with the weather, the winter weather. Hope to kick off the construction in the spring. The construction bid does allow us to consider additive projects, which we have identified. The state has told us to start the construction first, get into those pool walls and make sure that there's no problems, and then we can request the additives. Just a side note to that, we've already had those walls looked at by two different, an engineering firm as well as the architectural firm. And it looks like it's all good, but the state wanted us to do that once the construction begins, and then they also want a statement from the architect. So we have identified quite a number of additives. Once all of that's complete, the additives will be presented to the state for approval. The environmental has been submitted, and so at this point, we're just waiting on a release of funds. So concurrent to all of this, local government announced that projects now may be written for $750,000, so a joint project would be $1.5 million. So that's basically where we are right now with the current CDBG project.
I don't know, Manager Bellis, was there anything else you wanted to add to that?
Commissioners,
morning, Mr. Bellis. Just that, obviously, without the approval to proceed from the state, and it appears that due to staff cutbacks, they are severely undermanned up there, that the it really seems pretty impossible that we'll be ready in February to submit a second CDBG application, but it also seems that that is now going to be the trend, is that with the higher limits, they're going to allow more money look for projects that will be fully funded with the CDBG and the other funds that are identified in the applications, and that they'll all get done within a two-year time frame. So the idea we used to have of rolling over every year is pretty much gone. And part of that, to explain, is also because of the way the funds came in. If you're funding for a fiscal year, which is July 1, you put your applications in January, and they're not doing award letters till late fall, you're not going to be paving, you're not going to be doing the exteriors of buildings. And because of the state's situation, they used to basically advance the money under anticipation of receiving it, and because funds have now been delayed by the federal government getting down to the state doesn't have the cash cushion. The governor's office has directed that the departments can't release contracts to proceed until the state itself has the cash in hand from the federal government. And I think that covers it. French is going to talk a little bit about media when we get to that, where we are with it. Certainly that should continue to remain a priority for us, and there's a lot of work we can do between now and the next round of CDBG, identifying projects, identifying the rates of ways by description and estimated amount, and actually doing the acquisition of those rates of ways that we're going to need.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Romano. Mr. Bellis, was wondering if a surveyor had been hired for the Camino Medio project, I believe, that we spoke about that the last time.
I'm going to defer to French on that.
Okay.
Is anything else on CDBG?
No, that's it for right now.
No, Commissioner Romano.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Jones. So, correct me if I'm wrong, is what I hear, the county will not be able to apply for our own CDBG funds for two cycles now instead of the one?
Just one cycle.
So
we were awarded $750,000 in the last cycle. Now, those projects would have had been complete by February for that to happen.
And so I do not believe the commission has decided on the next round of cycling for CDBG. But I am hoping that there is a road in my district that I think would qualify for CDBG in the next funding cycle. And I'm a little disappointed that the deadlines weren't met. And you're saying the project is $750,000 instead of the million?
No, the threshold used to be maximum you could apply for as a local government, county, town, was $500,000. The state has now increased that threshold to $750,000. So for example, the town and the county both apply for a road project in theory, and we can't state now before the hearings what those priorities would be. That would be up to $1.5 million that would be available.
As a joint project?
On a joint project, correct. And the other thing that has happened, however,
that we can do in the meantime is that the state has put $1 million for the first time in years that anybody can remember into affordable housing under CDBG. So obviously the town and county both are working hard on affordable housing, and there's no reason we couldn't put in for that. That is a that money, and then the new economic development grants have no deadlines to them. You can put in any time throughout the year and they'll be reviewed. So if we're not going to do a road project, certainly town and the county should be looking at doing an economic development application and hopefully an affordable housing application. So there's no reason we still couldn't be bringing in potentially $2 million in this FY17-18 in CDBG funds into the county.
Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to say that when Rick Lopez was here, he suggested that the county do surveys on three or four different projects so they would be ready for approval. And I would suggest that we, even though we're having to wait, that we do identify those three or four projects so we could be ready in case one doesn't qualify. I'd still like to proceed with that.
It's just a test on the fire alarm system. There's no issue. I'm sorry, Commissioner.
So it would be nice, Mr. Chairman, if our county manager would talk to our grants administrator and that she could set in motion the identification of three or four projects. So in case one fails to meet the economic threshold, we have other ones we can fall back on. So I would like to see that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Blankenher.
Thank you, Chairman. Rick, how does the $1.5 million, are you expecting to be able to use the entire $1.5 million available for the project?
Yeah, absolutely, Commissioner Blankenhorn. There was a long list of things on there that didn't make the application because the architect's original projections were that we would need the full $1.5 just for the exterior structural. And we've gone over most of the items that we would also like to add on there, and they were bid that way in most circumstances as add-ons. And as Linda said, as long as the state's only hesitation is to approve them right now, is that in the past they've done projects like this where you have a warm air pocket on one side and a cold air on the other, where they found mold or rust or other problems. They just want to make sure, and again, we've had two engineering companies look at that, there wouldn't be a problem, but as soon as we open that wall and they visually can say there isn't, then we will proceed with all the add-ons.
And is it still the town's intention to apply for Medio, Camino del Medio, on the February 2018 deadline?
Well, as you're aware, Commissioner, we can't ever say ahead of time.
I am aware of it.
But we, in theory, can name priorities we anticipate, and in prior meetings, and there's been no change in that, the town is just as committed as the county is to wanting to see Medio widened, repaired, bike lanes, sidewalks, and improved as much as we possibly can.
Thank you.
And I would like to bring in
Mayor or Rick, now is it French or who's going to
French?
Yes, I am. Mr. Espinosa, thanks for being here this morning.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the council. Camino del Medio, well, I think the last time that I addressed both governing bodies at the joint county meeting, and I had mentioned a proposal that was given to us for the right-of-way survey, which entails a lot of different things. One of them, Commissioner Romero, is doing the actual survey, the survey work of the project. The other is doing the appraisal, and the other is actually making an offer and entering into negotiations and filing with the clerk. The price that we had got for that was in the neighborhood of $90,000, which I thought was a little pricey, and I wanted the opportunity to see if we could handle the project through the Public Works Department and break it up into its different components. As it turns out, the cost savings...
It's a test. We didn't study very hard.
So anyway, as it turns out, the cost savings on that is was minor. So what I've done is I've gone back to the original proposal and asked that the price be reduced to the neighborhood of $75,000. So that is where we are at today. And I have talked to local surveyors and local engineers along the process.
And so when do you expect to have all of that done?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Romero, I expect to have that done at the first of the year, at which time I will bring it back to both governing bodies for consideration.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. French, how far behind is Sauter Miller in their schedule?
They are not.
They are on schedule?
Yes.
And the right-of-way you speak of is out for the whole length of the road or the town's portion? I thought the county had money to do our own right-of-way.
Right. Mr. Chair, Commissioner O'Donnell, it is for the entire stretch of the roadway, which is 3.1 miles. So it does include both town and county. And I had spoken with Leandro and Brent right before the budgeting process. And so Taos County, along with the town of Taos, each budgeted funds for their respective portions of the roadway.
And then, is there any way you can fix your stretch of Camino Medio by Fred Baca Park to the bridge? And anyway, I believe is it in one of our commissioner's districts? So it's really bad on one lane. I mean, it's probably the worst road in the whole county. Is there any way you can fix that what you anticipate will actually see construction in a couple of years?
In a couple of years. So, Chairman Fango and Commissioner O'Donnell, it is my intent that when spring comes around, I will go back to the town house council and ask if we can overlay that roadway. We actually went and did some core samples of that. And what is below the roadway is clay. What is on top of the clay is about 1.5 inches of asphalt. So performing repairs to that is pretty significant. It's not a matter of milling stuff out and putting it back in, because there's not enough to mill out. So yes, I will continue to work on that.
And Mr. Chairman, if I would ask Commissioner to drive that road, so you know what I'm talking about.
Well, I do. I get plenty of complaints about that, even on the town side, forward to that narrow 32nd road. So we're well aware. We're getting quite a few phone calls on that over there. Anything else, Commissioner? Commissioner Blake.
Thank you, Chairman. So what do we have in the budget right now, town and county, to work on radio?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Blankenhorn, I believe that dollar amount is $170,000 each.
Each?
Yes.
And what are we going to spend that on, and when will we have it spent?
Again, it would be for the right-of-way survey, which includes all of the items that I had mentioned earlier,
right?
As well as for the acquisition. And if there is not going to be a joint town-county meeting anytime soon, I will bring that proposal back to the individual bodies.
Okay. And do you anticipate the $170,000 covering both the survey and all of the acquisitions required?
I do, not unless something really weird happens in the next 12 months. And again, it was an estimate that was developed at an appraisal from 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's actually identified in the engineering report.
And what's the timeline for expending the funds to complete the survey and all of the acquisitions?
Well, once we enter into an agreement, there should be some expenditures almost immediately. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But finish that portion of Camino del Medio completed. What's the timeline on that? To spend the entire 170 to have the survey and to buy everything that we're going to buy, why?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Blankenhorn, I don't want to speak on behalf of the engineer. However, it's our estimation that it should be somewhere within the neighborhood of 8 to 12 months.
Okay. Thanks.
And again, when we enter into an agreement, that's probably what I will recommend to both governing bodies.
Okay.
And before I go into Commissioner Romero, Commissioner O'Donnell, also to show that we've been keeping track of our road, there's been repairs at the Chamisa Medio intersection. This is the third time that we've done that.
And thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That's Commissioner Romero.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, and Mr. French, just with regards to the surveyor, who did you talk to that gave you the $90,000 figure?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Romero, the $90,000 price tag is not just the surveyor. It's the appraiser, and it's an appraiser that would make an offer, and it's the engineers that would identify the actual right of way. So the $90,000 tag includes all of that.
So who was the surveyor?
I had asked for a price from Rio Grande Survey, and I spoke with Abeta Engineering.
Does Abeta Engineering do survey?
No, but he would be doing another, or he could potentially do another portion of it.
I see. And so the last joint meeting that we had, we talked about a timeline like Commissioner Blankenhorn asked for. That was promised to this commission at that time, so I was just wondering as to when that would be coming at this point.
Again, Mr. Chair, Commissioner Romero, I can bring that back to you at the beginning of the year. When I addressed all governing bodies the last time, it was with the idea that we would break that project up and try to get the individual professionals involved. As it turns out, there's not very much of a cost savings. And therefore, what I've done is I've gone back to the original proposal to see if we can negotiate down to, again, somewhere in the neighborhood of $75,000. Yeah. And any time we do that, an employee of either one of the governing bodies becomes the actual project manager, which is sometimes a good idea and sometimes it's not. When you're dealing with five or four different other professions, it's a difficult task to keep all of those in mind. The last part of that, which I didn't mention, is that if the governing bodies intend to go after federal funds or even state funds, we have to follow that process. That means we have to take everything back to MMDOT. So I am not of any authority to be doing that versus a professional. So that's where that's the main tag right there is it has to go back to NMDOT for approval, which then would allow us to apply for state funding and federal funding.
So with the New Mexico Department of Transportation, are you having to deal with?
I would have to deal with people over at the general office, and I'm not really too sure who that is today.
So that relationship hasn't started yet? That communication hasn't started yet?
No, it has not, because we don't have anything to present to them.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. How many properties are affected by the right-of-way acquisition?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner O'Donnell, I believe there's somewhere in the neighborhood of 70.
70?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, and then I would ask, Mr. Chairman, if the county manager could
give us an update as to our plans for this project. It seems like we maybe wanted to move a little faster than the town, and Mr. French, I would recommend perhaps you get some assistance from the county in moving this project a little further along in a more expedited way. But could our county manager give us our plans? Because my understanding was we were going to do our own right of way, and then at that point next year we would ask the state legislature for funding. But could you kind of give us our...
So, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, we did think about that as an idea. We did reach out to Mr. Abita. Mr. Abita suggested we continue to keep the project as a whole and continue to work with the town. We do have a little less need, I believe, in terms of acquisition of property. Most of ours is kind of around the Chamisa intersection area. There's a few other, if I recall correctly, it's just along closer to the town area, but most of the acquisition we need is in the Chamisa area. So another thing that we're doing is working with the road department and Mr. Jaramillo to look at Chamisa as an alternative project as well, to engineer and maybe pave the rest of Chamisa Road and really engineer that intersection on our end, so that when everything is worked out, maybe we're ready to complete the entire intersection. So we do have our money set aside for the acquisition as was proposed in the engineering report, and we are excited to try and get going on the surveying as best we can. Do that. As I understand it, Mr. Abeta has already had a lot of contact with the property owners that we would need to negotiate with, and some pre-negotiation has kind of gone on, so that's why we reached out to him to continue to help us keep, you know, things moving and that good relationship he seems to have had with the property owners. That's where we're at. We're excited to keep moving, but we're going to also keep working on Chamisa Road to have a good cohesive intersection.
So, Mr. Chairman, I guess my question, Mr. French, is it would appear you're going to have more acquisition issues, and that your cost may be actually higher than what you've projected. Is that correct?
Mr. Chair, that may be correct, yes.
Well, I'm just hoping if there's some way the town, we can assist so we keep moving forward on this if you're bogged down. How many departments do you run? 10?
I run one department, but there's like 8 divisions in it.
So maybe at some point, if things are bogging down, maybe there's something we can do to assist you to get this going.
Mr. Chair, Commissioner O'Donnell, we have made contact with the grants administrator, Lori Montoya, to see if we could develop a plan to start doing the surveys, as you had mentioned earlier in the discussion, so that we can get ahead of the game when that time comes. So we've already identified the property owners, and we have this large map, and I'm sorry, I should have brought it with me today. But yeah, we continue to do things behind the scenes, so I do realize how important this is to the community and to the governing body, so.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Espinosa, for being in contact. Thank you for your updates.
Okay, moving on, Mayor. It's just a list. I mean, however you want to go on these, it's fine with us. We just listed some ideas there, but it's good for all of us to jointly talk about. We're not bound to all of that because it is a presentation. We don't limit anybody to what they present. But before you speak any further, I apologize, but I want to recognize Councilman Fritz Hahn, who's sitting in there. And it's hard for us to see Fritz because of the glare back there, but he's been working very hard on the joint proposals for herbicides. I don't get your emails anymore. We have an email issue here, but I trust that things are moving. It's not your fault. It's cyber fault. But thank you for being here.
Councilman Hahn, I did forget to recognize him and thank him for being here too. Again, next thing on the agenda is the update on 64 and 68. From 518, The first phase will be from 518 to Albertson's. Just use that as reference point, the turn from Pinasco to Albertson's, so everybody knows. Sometimes people don't know the roads in the 518. Basically, there'll be sidewalk work. There'll be a lot of it will be handicapped accessible issues that have come up, and there'll be an overlay of the whole entire stretch, including bike lanes. There'll be incorporating bike lanes both ways on that particular portion of the road. So that'll be started in the spring. There will be some acquisition of property that needs to be some right of way that they're currently working on. It was supposed to happen this year before the end of the year, but it did happen because of some acquisition of right of way that needed to take place before they proceeded. The other portion of it from Albertson's on through town, that is in the planning stage right now. There's been several meetings. The proposed stretch, and French, you might need to help me with this a little bit, is there's going to be four lanes. There's going to actually be a light that will be installed here at Albright. There'll be four lanes from Albertson's all the way into Randall Lumber, and then it'll narrow down to two lanes through the rest of the stretch. And again, there'll be sidewalks and bike lanes incorporated in those also. That's the proposal to this point. They're still having a couple of public hearings. You know, they have some additional funding that they needed to continue with that portion. I believe that funding has been now identified. So in the following year, which would be 2018, that portion of the road will be addressed. So we have 2017 coming up, which will address from 518 to Albertson's. 2018 will address the other portion of the road with the light to on Albright here. So again, we're trying to get that pushed up forward, so maybe we can get it done in 2017, the later portion, but we don't know yet.
And I sure hope to finish Salazar extension so that there's an alternate while the 2017 project.
Correct. That particular portion of it has been let already, and they're currently working on that. So hopefully by this, I want to say by the spring, that portion of the road will be open and be able to use as an alternate bypass on.
And that's going to
alternate route. And we also paved, you know, a portion of Albright and Gustorf, so that people can actually use that also. So we can funnel some of the traffic as it builds up on some of the other roads during the construction phase.
Commissioners? The other thing, and it's not related to this part because you said 518 to here, but eventually we need to look at that intersection. There was another accident at C-110 and 68 again yesterday, so we need to put that on our radar. So 68 is going to be a hot topic for us.
It's probably going to require a light at some point. One of the things that, too, with the Department of Transportation that we've been asking for, too, is, you know, we do have traffic that backs up all the way from the plaza all the way to Albright a lot of times in the day. And there, at one time, there was a proposal for one-way pairs that's been shut down. Unfortunately, we could have at least tried it, and it's been shut down at this point. But some kind of lighting so that the lights are a little better situated or maybe timed correctly so that we can move traffic through our community a little better. People don't like to sit in traffic for 45 minutes to get from one end of town to the other. So we're working on it. We're trying to be very diligent with the Department of Transportation and continuing those conversations with the governor where the money originally came from.
Commissioner Romero. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, for being here. Really appreciate your presence. I had asked that it be on the agenda, but it didn't get listed for today's meeting. But with regards to the ETC zone, there have been a lot of conversation, a lot of rumors, a lot of stuff going on this last month and a half or so as to what the town was doing and just kind of wanted to hear it from you as to...
Well, there's really not an ETZ zone, basically, and I'll let Rick talk to it a little bit better if I don't hit all the points. Basically, we are required to plan a mile outside our jurisdiction, and the reason for that planning of that mile is so that we, if there's roads that are being, I want to say, additional subdivisions from the county that are coming forward, that or planning for additional roadways from the town that are coming forward, that they align, water lines align, and all the infrastructure aligns, sewer, so if there's a subdivision that's going to be in the county that aligns with our sewer for the town, that there can actually be hookups. And so there's always that, you know, we want to plan for that. So there's alignment of roads, alignment of sewer, alignment of water. Otherwise, you know, a road could not align. We have that a lot in the community where there wasn't planning, forward planning, but no DETZ zone. That, just planning so that we can have that alignment.
Or annexation.
Or we don't have any plans on annexation unless somebody, you know, from the county was to come to the town and ask for that, and then it would be on them. We're not planning on annexing. One of the things that we would hopefully, eventually, in some of this planning is around the airport. We would love to, you know, see some opportunities, the town and the county working together on a joint venture, you know, because the airport lies within the county, you know, and we want to make sure that as we get, that gets built out, that there's, you know, some opportunities within the community in that area.
But no more of the spaghetti annexation, is it?
I think we, you know, there was a lot of fight over that. That wasn't under my administration, but we got that worked out, and we want to make sure that we can continue to move forward. But we do need to plan for the future. You know, if there's any, you know, subdivisions within the county, subdivisions in the town, that, you know, the roads line up, sewer lines up, water lines up, and we just want to make sure that we're planning for that.
Thank you.
And one of the other things that what did make it on the agenda is maybe a little update on affordable housing. And if we can have latitude for that.
I'm assuming at 6460.
Yes, I did. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you very much for the free concert you gave this weekend. I enjoyed it very much. It was a great thing to do for the citizens of Taos. On Highway 64, 68, could you refresh my memory? I think town and county had wanted the four lane. There was some pushback from the public. They didn't want the four lane. But so did DOT change the plans then when you're talking about a four-way up to Randall's? Did they accommodate us? Because at one point I thought they had talked about just a three-way from...
At the current proposal, there's a four-way. There's four lanes in the current proposal. In the last public hearing, that was what was presented, was four lanes.
Okay, and then?
And then it nicks down to two lanes at right at the area of Randall's.
Okay.
With a realignment of that offset of the jog of those two roads there?
Siler.
Okay,
and then are we getting a street light again at Albright?
Yes, that is in the proposal.
So we'll align to TIVA? Is that the street
light? It is currently aligned.
Okay, so we will get the street light.
Yes.
All right, okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and under economic development, basically, you know, as we move forward in the community, we try to create a group of people working on economic development, and when people come to the community and they're wanting to do things, we're trying to put together an economic development group. And I would love if somebody from the county would be on that economic development committee. We would love to see somebody, and if you would make a recommendation to us, whether it be, you know, some people say that it shouldn't be an elected official, but whatever your guys, so if a opportunity comes to us and you've already reviewed it and you've been part of a group reviewing it, then when it comes to you, it's hard for you to make that vote because you've already seen all of it.
So it might be a good idea if it wasn't a public official, but we take a public official if that's who you guys wish to appoint.
And the affordable housing?
And affordable housing, I'll turn to Rick, give you an update on that. We did create an affordable housing task force committee at pretty much similar to the economic development task force. And, you know, we want to make sure that as we move forward, that all our I's are dotted and T's are crossed, and we have as many eyes looking at it as possible. There's great opportunities. We need housing in our community. Some of the things that have happened, and I don't know if you're aware of it, but hopefully you guys will pass an ordinance too similar to the one we passed, because more and more of our housing are going to Airbnbs. During the downturn in our economy, there was a lot of houses that were bought up by investors because they were, I guess, easily purchased because they were in foreclosure. And so we had a lot of investors come in and buy some of those foreclosures, and now they're on Airbnbs. So our long-term rentals in our community have become a problem. We have fewer and fewer long-term rentals, so it's really creating a hardship on a lot of people that live here because there's not long-term rentals. So that leads us to our housing shortage, and so I'm going to let Mr. Bellis speak a little bit about that if we're allowed to do that, because it's not on the agenda.
Well, just as I stated before, Mayor, presentations, we don't restrict anybody what they present on. We didn't have anything listed on Ms. Mulvaney, and she was able to talk about what she needed to address us on. This is pretty much, we were just letting the public know things that were most likely going to be talked about today.
Thank you, Chairman. And this is a great one because it's, you know, again, the town and the county working together on two different possibilities. You know, you guys have your piece of property on Herdner that has been, is becoming available. I guess some work's being done. People are, staff is moving out toward the airport on the piece of property that the town has provided out there. And it would then free up some opportunities for affordable housing, and an RFP has gone out. We did have two respondents, and I'll just turn it over to Mr. Bellis and give you a little final.
And in addition, this is not an action item.
Mr. Chairman, if I just have a message to Mr. French, if there was a way, if you're in communication with DOT about the widening of into a four lane and right on our side of the property next to Cunningham. So Mr. Cunningham had asked about an easement to pull into his property right there. And if the highway department is going to be re-engineering, perhaps they can accommodate him with a turnout right there before Rio Fernando, you know, where his property is. Those talks have stalled with us, but if it's something the highway department might be able to consider when they're widening the road and doing pullouts, maybe it would be good to talk to Mr. Cunningham about that and see if that's possible.
I'll go ahead and address that. The Department of Transportation has asked each property owner along that stretch to have a personal invitation to meet with them. So if he wants to bring that to DOT, he can actually do that at that time, because the DOT has set a priority to meet with all the property owners along that stretch.
Who's that contact?
At Department of Transportation. Do you know who? Antonio Jaramillo.
Okay. Thank you.
Chairman, Commissioners, I'll just make it very quick. Just to let you know, we have been moving on the affordable housing on Mary Medina property, which is 2 acres. The state has acquiesced to allow that to be used for affordable housing. I know that the county's still working on the 3 acres of the 5 acres. And we have offered, in fact, to help with those costs out of the affordable housing fund the town has. There was an RFP. There were two respondents. Both respondents put in for
both of the projects. I'm very happy to have Commissioner Blankenhorn sitting on that review committee. As he will tell you that initially, we just reviewed the credentials to see whether they have the capacity to do the projects and whether they have a familiarity with New Mexico's tax credit, low-income housing tax credit system. Both looked very good. We came up at the meeting with a series of questions for both of them to further define. We're hoping that through January they can answer those questions. By the end of January, we'll do a either on-site or by a conference call interview with both of the parties. And the town will be moving ahead with some zoning changes to accommodate maximum development permissible on those properties. And I also want to say the maximum flexibility, because we are looking not just to zero lot line block out and affect the neighbors, we're looking to create some create a green space, open space, and a mix of housing, particularly on the urban property between townhouses, maybe homeownership, upstairs, downstairs, and then your traditional apartment style. So we're feeling very positive about it. Unfortunately, due to the delays, both we and the county encountered and tried to clear these properties, we can't make the current February deadline for tax credits. There's a really remote chance on the Mary Medina piece we might, but we recorded the RFP that both developers have a series of community meetings to allow the neighbors to have input into the impact and design of communities, so they feel it's an asset. In the case of Herdner, we realized there are a number of dirt alleyways that used to be family subdivisions that are now publicly owned outside of families. So we certainly anticipate that we'll make a priority to widen, do drainage, curb and gutter, sidewalks, bike lanes, and other infrastructure improvements in that neighborhood that we hope that the neighbors will find enhances their neighborhood in addition to the project.
That's Mr. Chairman, Mr. Romero, how much property is involved on that? That's the entire piece, but how much of it?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, the entire parcel is a little over 5 acres. We have clear title to 2 acres, and we've been working on the 3 acres that was conveyed from the state back in the 80s. And I do want to, if I have a moment, I just want to update the commission. We've had a lot of help from Commissioner Bankenhorn, our county assessor, Mr. Montoya, and even Ms. Cordova, the treasurer's office, to try and look back to the 80s and prove that we made the payments to the state. Unfortunately, it doesn't appear that the final conveying of the property and the recording of the deed happened. We can prove $25,000 out of 50 that we did make payments on, and I'm very confident that we're going to find the rest. And I'm grateful for the history that we have in the county that is helping us get to that point. But once we prove it, then we need to go back to the state and make sure that the state conveys property. At this point, we probably would just ask them to convey directly to the town. And I'm very grateful to the town for giving us the property they have out there by the landfill so that we can start moving everything over. And as you can notice, Herdner looks less and less lived in, so to speak. We're getting rid of the scoria, and there's a lot of equipment that will be going out to auction here soon, which will clear up that. So that's where we're at now. We're still working to get the clear title for the 3 acres at the state.
So is there a need for additional land in that area, or is the 5+ acres sufficient?
The project's being planned around the 5 acres, and both of the proposals that have been submitted, and the town had Santa Fe Housing did a preliminary that would fit on that site as a last resort as well. So we're going to modify the zoning slightly right now. That property is a C2 commercial, which would accommodate residential, but we want, again, to give the neighborhood some kind of assurance that'll be in there. So we think both projects can be successfully awarded by June, ready to go for tax credits by the end of 17. And the preliminary work will be done ahead of time by the developers. And if they're funded in February of 18, it could be under construction by spring of that year. Okay. And certainly we're going to continue with the county to try to identify additional sites that we can work on, whether they be private and we can partner by providing infrastructure or being passed through for the tax credits.
Is there a certain radius as to what these projects have to be in? Or?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, and the county manager and myself have had that discussion, and because in order to be eligible for the financing, they have to be within walking distance of schools, shopping, public transportation, bikeways. Really, if you take the area within the town of Taos between Salazar and Gustorf, and then take it to the plaza down to 518, that is really the only place in the entire county that you're going to get reasonable enough tax credits and subsidies that you're going to be able to make it truly affordable.
Thank you. It's kind of perceived that we swapped land with you guys for out at the this is an equitable swap. No, that's our skin in the game in helping to promote the affordable housing, and because of the site, as you just explained.
Mr. Chairman, I really appreciate
that. There were two separate issues that just happened at the same time.
And lastly, I would like to thank the county manager that I think we continue to work on a plethora of other projects, such as the detox, the animal shelter, in which we're working very well cooperatively with the entities out in the community. And I think people appreciate seeing the partnerships that we're cooperating in. Thank you very much.
Commissioner Blankenhorn.
Thank you, Chairman. Thanks, Rick. Yeah, it was heartening to see that there were two very qualified contractors, and appreciate the town's intention to modify the zoning, because you know obviously the need for the number of units is so great, and without any modification you get maybe 80, but we can get closer to 100, especially if you go up higher. I know you guys have some height issues at the town, you know, some controversies, but I'm hoping that there'll be sufficient flexibility for that in the zoning code. Your zoning code is way too complicated for me, but I think, in my opinion, if we work in that direction, you know, it's going to make a big difference. We have such a big deficit. And also, as you mentioned, you know, the mixed incomes, you know, it can help with some of the stuff that the mayor was talking about, and it also just makes for a better project when it's not all low-cost housing in the same place. It's a point that Commissioner Gallegos made at the last joint meeting, and I think it's a really, really important one too. So yeah, look forward to it. I like the timeline that you presented, and I do have a little bit of a concern that we might not be able to get the tax subsidy that's necessary for it to work on both projects. And I know there's some discussion of combining the projects, but you know, good communication with MFA on that, try and figure out which is the best way to go, you know, and if it's important for us to start with her because we can get more units there, then that's the direction we should go, in my opinion.
Commissioner Blankenhorn, I have put in a call to MFA that we consider both sites as a single project.
Great, that's really good.
Because of the funding here.
That's really good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Mayor, we also want to recognize your fire chief Leroy Gonzalez is here too, in case you have any questions or anything.
Yes, and that, you know, and you know, we talked about the economic development, and I'll just kind of mention it. You know, when we have economic development, one thing that we're working on right now is a joint community training center. And I know this is just right now, we're just talking about it. There's opportunities that we're working on. There's funding that we're working on already, but this is an economic opportunity that would really enhance our community. Because, you know, where we live and fire all around us and, you know, and we're getting taller buildings and different infrastructure, and we want to make sure that they're, you know, in our volunteer fire department is aging, and we want to make sure that as, you know, our youth come up, there's opportunities to get people trained, and it would be, you know, I want to say we can reach to Southern Colorado to the middle of the state to, as a training facility, and I just wanted to mention it. But this is part of that economic development opportunities that we have in our community. And I just want to wish everybody in the room Merry Christmas. We're going to be giving a little bit back to the community again. We have a New Year's celebration coming up. It's New Year's Eve. It starts at 7 o'clock. We will be having, I will be very careful with my words. I want to say a montanza, but we'll be having a pig roast on the plaza. It'll be free. There we will be having, for those that don't eat meat, there will be potatoes and carrots and corn and cobbler. We will have our big screen TV set up. We will have the countdown from New York. It'll end at 10 o'clock so that we can get our youth and people that, because we really want to extend it out to our youth. It'll be a drug-free, alcohol-free event. We will also have the dam band there, and we'll have a number of other, we'll have a balloon release. If you're wanting to get rid of some of your thoughts, some of your frustrations, you can write them on a balloon and we'll turn them loose at midnight. After that, there will be an opportunity for our youth to hang around. We'll try to get the adults out of there so the youth can have some fun. We will be having a laser light show and some additional music for them to dance to so that they have a place to hang out if there's not a place for them to hang out in the community. So again, just want to wish everyone fireworks. Dale, I'm sorry, forget about that. Chief, smack me upside the head. We will have a great firework show also. It will be bigger than last year. And it's a great show that our fire department will be putting on. So again, just want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And again, a collaboration in our community is what makes things work. And we have a good understanding. Commissioner O'Donnell, music event that was put on at the TCA, that you saw all the different cultures, all the different from the youth to the older people working together on one stage, and that's what our community can do, and that's the type of events that can come from that. And it doesn't have to be an event, it could just be our community and a whole, all of us working together, whether we have white, brown, yellow, pink skin, we can all work together. So,
again, Commissioner Blake, you were the first.
Thanks, Chairman, and thanks, Mayor, and everybody from the town who showed up today. Really informative. I think we're moving forward on all this stuff. Just two more quick ones. Let's identify a joint economic project that we can apply CDBG. Let's get some more of that money in town. I don't know what the ideas are, but I'm sure you guys...
Rather than work against each other, let's be in competition.
Right, let's try to get something identified sooner than later. So there's that, right? And then one more thing, how quick are we going to get the detox building? Are we going to get the detox building? What's up with that?
No problem.
Okay, we've committed to that.
Good.
What's the timeline?
The honorable.
Yeah, great. Mr. Chairman, Mr. Mayor will get you a letter, a request letter, if that's appropriate with you, and we'll get that to you hopefully before your first meeting in January.
Okay.
Hopefully we can go from there.
Okay.
So we get a letter and then you guys have to do whatever?
30 days, 45 days.
45 days for what?
Approval of DFA.
DFA. And what paper, if we just have to do a letter, what's the paper that you guys have to get to DFA?
Okay.
No, it's just a tech.
So it's just a technicality. Whenever there's a transfer of property, we have to do DFA. So we can physically convey the title to you and have all the paperwork done. I've never seen them that approve a transfer of government to government.
No, I'm sure that
the appraisal's already done.
Mr. Chairman, sometimes it's helpful if both the entities do the resolutions. We would accept the donation
they would authorize, and then we could get a deed and it could all go to DFA for approval as a final transaction. Although it's not literally final until they approve.
We can get our resolution on our January agenda.
Probably the second one.
Okay, so that'll be our promise, is we'll get the resolution on our second January meeting.
We will, the managers and attorneys will coordinate on the paperwork to get it done as quickly as possible.
Thank you.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I went to the last New Year's Eve party. It was really fun. And I wanted to point out, I really appreciate your Fartalito schedule that you have on the Taos Plaza. I enjoyed looking at all the groups. Perhaps next year we could get on the list to light Fartalito's 1 year. I did want to point out that since I have the list in front of me today, the district attorney's office will be lighting the Fartalito's on the plaza. And then I wanted to point out, you do have a special event tomorrow inviting anyone who wants to come to light a candle for a loved one. And so what time, if anyone would like to be on the plaza and light, help light the Fartalito's, remember loved ones, what time should they be there?
That's usually at dusk.
At dusk. All right, thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
Again, yes.
Don't go ahead, sorry.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mayor.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, French.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for a 5 minute break.
And a motion for a 5 minute break.
Second.
And a second. Clerk, call the roll.
No, it doesn't.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Commissioner Fadenberg.
Yes.
Chairman Bellis.
Yes.
How are you? Very good.
A motion to come back into order, commissioners.
So moved.
We have a motion to come back into session. I'll second it. I want to go home sometime this month. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Commissioner Blakenhouse.
Yes.
Chairman Kevin.
Yes. All right, moving on to item 9A under contracts, agreements, MOUs, RFPs, and bids. This is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding the renewal of amendment of Taos County contract TCC 2016-007 with the Humane Society of Taos, doing business as Stray Hearts Animal Shelter. This will be presented by our attorney, Ms. Susan Baker. And I want to recognize the president of the board, Pam Miller, and our interim director still, Diane Paddock. They're in the audience as well. If we had, if they needed to be part of the discussion, thank you for being here. Susan.
Before you, as an amendment, an extension of our previous contract with Stray Hearts, the contract is a reduced amount of $12,000 per month, and it's for January 1st, 2017 through June 30th, 2017. In our original contract, paragraph 8, you should have a copy of that original contract in your packets, there's a termination provision that allows either party, the county or Stray Hearts, to give 30 days notice and to terminate the contract with or without cause. The 30 days begins running upon receipt of the notice by the other party. So we have a 6 month extension, but again, either party can terminate the contract with 30 days notice if need be, with or without cause.
Mr. Porter.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I do want to just put out there that we've been working really closely with the board, Ms. Diane is the interim director, the town. We've all been talking about this together, and they've come a really long way. I want to thank them for the hard work they've put into the shelter. They've had a lot of obstacles, I guess is the best way to put it, and I think they're overcoming every one of them, and it's just the dedication from these two and everyone around them and the hard work. And at this point, the county, we need them, and they need us, and we want to continue to work together, and I really appreciate all the good faith and the hard work and how we can continue to move forward. So I just wanted to put that out there and thank them for everything they've been doing for the community.
Commissioner Bellis.
Commissioner Blakenhorn.
Thank you, Chairman. Thanks to Andro and Susan for your work on this, and everybody from Stray Hearts. What is the status of spay neutering? Well, you know, we've always discussed the fact that the county has extra funds. We've given some of those funds to the sheriff, who has used a portion of them, but, you know, we wanted to partner with Stray Hearts to spay neuter, since you guys have the equipment and you've hired Holly, and you know, we want a very reasonable, close to cost price that we can rely upon, so that we can find additional funds and spay neuter animals in our community for free or for a very low price, with the only obligation to the owner to buy one of our licenses. So far, I think the only licenses we've sold is to Ivan, that fellow who's up on the drug charges. So we have not sold very many licenses. And, but you know, the point is, you know, we've talked about this for over a year now, and I don't see anything in the extension about it, and I haven't heard any news about it. Penny called me the other day, and I said, I have no idea what's going on. So what's going on?
So, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I'm not going to speak for all of the efforts, but I'll tell you that when these ladies took over, I don't think that there was a very much of a foundation for what we were looking for. And I will say they put in a lot of the work to get that foundation built, and I do think they are working on spay and neuter. I'll let them go a little further into that. But basically, by them allowing us to go back to the $12,000 a month that we were used to, we didn't have to tap into those funds that we had set aside for spay and neuter. So those are still available for spay and neuter. So that, to me, is a progressive part of this negotiation. We still have that money available for that spay and neuter, and I do think, and I'll ask them maybe to chime in a little bit more on their efforts, but I know they put in a lot of work to get better prepared to be able to do spay and neuter. Is that true?
And I was going to add that, Mr. Chairman, sorry, I was going to add that we had a meeting where they explained to us that they are doing a significant amount of spay and neuter. In addition to that, they have rebuilt relationships with some of the other shelters out of state, so they've been able to transport a significant number of dogs. And yeah, they can explain that as well.
Commissioner O'Donnell also has a comment too, so we can incorporate all that.
So, Mr. Chairman, my question to legal, as one of the commissioners has expressed, may we amend this contract to include that Stray Hearts collects license fees and turns them over to the county? This is something we have talked about would be a way we could get more dogs licensed. And so, are we able for this contract to add an amendment and for legal to find a way to, way that Stray Hearts could collect and give out dog licenses or some mechanism?
This contract before you is just really an extension of our previous contract. It's an amendment of the amount, $12,000 a month rather than the $14,000. But the original contract allowed for three renewals. This would be two out of three renewals. So this extension is brief with the intention, and I'll let Pam and Diane explain more about this, that Stray Hearts is looking at its organization. It's reworking a lot of things. The executive director left in August, and I think they can speak best to that. I'm not sure it's in anyone's best interest to change the scope of work at this time. I mean, we could do that in June, but that would be my recommendation, and give them some time to decide what direction they're taking. To be frank, there's been talk of possibly the county getting into the business of an animal shelter, and there's just a lot of discussion on the table, and I think to add an extra layer of scope of work at this time may not be in anybody's best interest until we have more dialogue.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Good morning. Thanks for being here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So there were a lot of different themes that were put before us, questions, and we put together some talking points regarding some of the accomplishments that we've made since August. And one of the first, I think, answers Commissioner Blankenhorn's questions, at least where we are to start. So as you all know, we did hire Dr. Holly Johnson. She started in September, and one of the first things she did, we hired her as on a contract basis, where she worked 20 hours a week as our relief shelter vet and 5 hours a week as a consultant to help us put together the program of what the shelter vet operations at Stray Hearts should look like. And part of that process was what we need to do with spay-neuter, not only for our own animals, but also for the public. One of the first things that we did after she went through and updated all of our surgical equipment and ensured that we were set and ready to go, it hadn't been used in a long time, and so it was nice. Some of the things were obsolete, some of the things just needed maintenance. But one of the first things we did was at the end of October, we eliminated what was called the Foster to Adopt program. And what happened before this was that animals were allowed to leave the shelter in a foster to adopt program where they weren't actually spayed or neutered. They then went into the public and came back at some point to put down a deposit, came back at some point to either be spayed or neutered during one of our clinics or went to a local vet and then produced the paperwork so we could finalize it. What happened was we discovered many animals in the public that had not been spay or neutered. And so we have a backlog of those animals that we have to catch up so we can finalize those adoptions. Also, we started spaying and neutering our animals before they leave. So the current policy, and the policy since the end of October, excuse me, is that no animal leaves the shelter without being spay or neutered, period. And so what we've been doing since then is getting caught up, and it's going to, quite frankly, take us a couple of months to get caught up with all of the animals that are out in the former Foster to Adopt program, as well as continue to foster ours. Dr. Holly works only part-time. She's 25 hours a week, and she also is our relief vet, so she's taking care of our animals, as well as performing the surgeries. But we did alter 55 animals in the month of November and month to date, 42. And we're continuing to ramp up as she's training people. It's not just the vet that you need. It's really important that you also have a vet tech there. And so she's working on training. We do expect to begin to offer public spay neuters sometime in spring, but we can't be more definitive upon that until we get caught up to where we are now. We're doing everything we can to reduce expenses and to ensure that we operate as effectively and efficiently as possible. And with that, the Foster to Adopt program, we have eliminated, and I'm not talking about the spay-neuter aspect of it, I'm talking about animals who, what Foster Adopt was supposed to mean, is that animals leave the shelter altered and go into a home for a week or two to ensure that the match works, that the conditions are right, the animal gets along with the other animals and the children, and gives the public a mechanism for the animal to come back without penalty if there's an issue. We found that from a cat perspective, it's not an issue, and so we've eliminated Foster Adopt with cats. With dogs, we reduce that so it's only a week. The reason why that's important from a budget perspective is that an animal in foster to adopt is technically still an animal that belongs to the shelter, not the owner. So we're responsible for any medical or any other care that that animal requires. This way, we reduce our expenses in the medical and our vaccinations tremendously. We have animals in foster to adopt for 6 months. I just ran a report of animals 9 months or longer, and we have over 65 that are in foster to adopt, either because the paperwork hasn't been completed or because we haven't completed the spay-neuter piece. Some of the other successes, the beginning of August, we had 110 dogs housed at the shelter, and we only have capacity for 84 inside. That meant we had 26 dogs living in outside kennels, which is not ideal in the summer, but it's not horrible. In winter, it's not something that we can do. So we've worked on three major areas. One, ensuring that our adoptions, our animals are adoptable, trained, worked with, so that we have more adoptions. But also we've repaired a lot of our broken relationships we had with transfer partners throughout Colorado. And I give a lot of credit to Donna Storch, who's our volunteer transfer coordinator, as well as a new board member. She was sort of pushed out of that process for a while, and the relationships were fairly broken. But she's repaired those, and we have transferred in the last 4 months 212 animals into primarily Colorado. What is really exciting is that we have, because of our new philosophy with the spay-neuter and not allowing animals to go out and foster, we have repaired relationships with Santa Fe and Espanola. They would not work with us because they were so opposed to the prior philosophy. And for the first time, at least that I know of, we transferred cats last week. So we transferred 16 cats, 8 to Espanola and 8 to Santa Fe, as well as a few dogs to Espanola. And that has not happened in the past. As of this morning, we have 72 dogs at the shelter, and 10 have already been adopted, but they're going home the week between Christmas and or New Year's, or they will leave once their spay-neuter is completed. Holly's completing 9 or 8 dog surgeries today, so animals can be home in time for Christmas. As of today, we have 44 cats at the shelter. We had almost 100 in August, so we've been working really hard. And what's happened, not just with our shelter, but in shelters throughout the West, because of the warm weather and how late the weather went, kitten season lasted longer than most people have ever remembered. So we had kittens coming in into November, which is not usual. So I'm also very proud to say we reduced the average length of stay for our animals during the past 4 months. We went from 49.5 days year to date on August 15th to, as of last week, 24.9. So we've reduced almost in half the length of stay for our animals. So we are focusing on operations. We are focusing on budget. We created a zero-based budget in October that I work on with our volunteer bookkeeper. We looked line by line, looked at every single cost of the shelter. Once that was completed, we sent that budget to a finance committee that we created that was comprised both of our board, the public, people who have financial background, as well as animal welfare experts. Can you put those on in the audience? And once we agreed that we were at that base budget, we sent that budget. So we were working closely with the town and county, and both county managers, county and town manager managers had a chance to review and provide feedback on the budget. So those are some highlights, but we're here to answer any specific questions of anything else you might be looking for.
Commissioner Blankenmaier. Thank you, Jimmy. Those are huge improvements. Oh my goodness, what a big change from what we were dealing with before the UNM took over. Really, really appreciate it. And I understand you've got a backlog and you're finishing up with your backlog and, you know, Holly filling over 25 hours a week. But in the spring, what could it look like in the spring if we come up with some more money to subsidize public spending?
One of the things that Holly's looking at are additional vets who can come in and help. And she has great contacts. So she's talking to the vets that work both at Espanola and Santa Fe and trying to look at some sort of a rotating schedule so that we don't have the funds at Stray Cats, but the funds will provide it and we can do 2 or 3 days. You know, we're trying to, I would say, try to fill whatever days we can based on the funding that we can get to do that. We found that we can do 30 to 35 animals a day. There's a difference between, and learning from Holly, there's a difference between vets that are used to high volume spay neuter and just a vet. And the ones that this is what they do can sometimes do, depending upon cats, numbers of cats and dogs, males and females, each one takes a different amount of time, but somewhere between 30 and 45 And so what she's looking at is working to see who might be available to come out of our shelter, work on the days that she's either not there or assist her. So I would sort of flip it, which is we have a budget, we can work to that budget in terms of what we can do. But she's working very hard to build those relationships with vets who would be willing to come here and do this.
So 30 to 45 a day, what might that cost per day?
The funds that we're looking at and all of the work that she's doing based on the meds and the vet tech and the vet nurse, it's an average of $80 per animal for which sounds, I know it sounds really high, but I can tell you that as we've looked at vet vets, they'll charge anywhere from 100 to, we actually had somebody who adopted one of our dogs, had them neutered in Colorado, and told us that they spent $325 for that. So remember, the cost goes into not only the medicine, it goes into the vet, it goes into the vet techs. So for right now, best guess, and what we budgeted per animal in our budget is the $80 per animal figure, which is less than what our partners are charging per animal.
Which partners?
We worked with both dogsters, and we've worked, we actually haven't technically worked with, but we've assisted as some of our other animal welfare experts have worked with CNRA, as well as discussed. I don't know if the sheriff has anything to add. I know he's worked quite a lot with Santa Fe, with the per animal cost there.
And how about selling licenses? I mean, I'd be happy if you kept the money.
So you would like clarification that we've been told that that's not something we can do legally, equally, but so I would say that we would love to participate in that if the legal aspects can work.
Right, well, yeah.
Yeah.
We could correct it so whatever technicalities, I know how those lawyers are.
But as far as working together, so on that point of adoption, we'd love to be able to figure that out. Right now we have the adoption, the licensing paperwork, and so we can give it to them, and then they take it to the process, but I have no idea if and when they do that.
So we have, the county has not gotten that procedure to you to make it easy for you to sell licenses?
We don't have a process.
You don't have any process in place
to sell licenses.
But this is something that we're working on still?
Yes, it sounds like. And it's something that's still new in this paper. We had a really got her up to speed in this conversation, so if we're talking on the sidebar here, we think there's a chance that maybe in the springtime we can do something, but we haven't really worked out the process.
Okay. All right, well, I'll mark it down for the spring then. That'd be spring 2017. Okay, thank you. Thank you, really so much, honestly, for all you've done.
2 years ago today, my gypsy came to live with me. Aww. She never lived back. The majority of her first 3 years, her birthday just occurred, it was on the 12th. The majority of our first 3 years were in the shelter, and our family very grateful to
thank you.
And thank you to Leandro and the commissioners and Susan for being willing to work so closely with us. We can't do it alone.
We've had great meetings with the town, the county, sheriff, and we're working together to figure out what we need to do to once and for all create the business model that is sustainable and effective for Strike Hearts. The current one is not, and that is something that we're all working on very closely and collaboratively together, so thank you.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you so much for everything you do. Any word on when you might have an executive director?
So we conducted six phone interviews, and then recommended four to go to our executive search committee. We've narrowed it down to our top two. We feel, and they feel actually, that based on kind of where we are with contract negotiations, having somebody come on full time right now may not be the best time. We're hoping to fill it within a month or two. However, we are pleased to announce that one of our top candidates, who happily lives in Santa Fe, we just hired her as a consultant. She will be working 2 days a week, Fridays and Saturdays. She is an expert in shelter operations. She's been an executive director before for 2 years, and she has the experience in the operational side of the shelters that I don't. And so we'll be working as a team with, her name is Suzanne. Suzanne and I, as well as the board, on figuring out exactly what we need to really, if you think we've made accomplishments now, thank you. But once we have someone who knows what we're doing involved, we think it's just going to be dramatic. So she starts the first weekend in January. She'll be working Fridays and Saturdays. And it's a consultant, but our tentative title is Shelter Operations Director. So I look forward to, Leandra has met her. I look forward to all of you meeting her when she's here.
Thank you.
All right. This is an action item. I did hear recommendation from our attorney to go with this. I entertain a motion.
So moved.
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion and a second to approve the renewal and amendment of the Taos County contract TCC 2016-007 with the Humane Society of Taos. Doing business at Stray Hearts Animal Shelter. Further discussion? Hearing none, clerk call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenher?
Yes.
Chairman Fowler?
Yes. Thank you all. Okay, item B. Discussion, consideration, and decision regarding the approval of Amendment 1 to the Waste Management Franchise Agreement. Ms. Quaynell Robinson, thank you for being here.
Good morning, Mr. Chair. Good morning, Ms. Commissioner. I'll be brief. I know everybody's hungry. this is the last year we renewed our franchise agreement with Waste Management for everyday trash collection. This is an update of the rates from last year. They did go up about $2, as we expect, as we all know, the price of gas and gas isn't always logical. it's also tied to services and a number of other things, but I did want to report that we were able, at the suggestion of Mr. Manager, to implement a discount for senior citizens. It was previously not available. That would be $3 less for residential collection, and we were able to talk them into service for the disabled, which involves wheeling the cart out to the street for pickup. So those are big victories that we didn't have last year, especially with our senior population in rural areas. So the new rates are attached to your Exhibit B. So stand for any questions.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Any ideas to how much our seniors will be able to save on how many there are that are going to actually fall into this category?
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Romero, I don't have that data. That would be a question for solid waste, but I can ask them to follow up with you as to the number of current customers that we have.
That would be great. Thank you very much.
You want to make a motion?
I will make a motion, Mr. Chairman, to approve the First Amendment to the exclusive franchise agreement between Taos County and Waste Management of New Mexico Incorporated.
Okay, you heard the motion to approve Amendment 1 of the Waste Management franchise. And I have a second.
With discussion,
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Ms. Robinson, how long is this contract good for?
I believe the term should be through August 31st, 2019. So quite a bit longer.
And could you check why there's no service up in Pinasco for the future?
I could. I don't know. I will check with Waste Management and get a list of, actually,
it's not, is it in here?
Let me double check. I think it might be. Their Exhibit B will be all of your rates, and then it shows which areas are covered. Let's see. Pinasco is covered, Commissioner O'Donnell. If you look on solid waste collection fees, it's the first page of your Exhibit B. There'll be a bullet point A, residential collection. Bullet point one would be prices for Arroyo Hondo, Arroyo Seco, Desmontes, Las Colonias, Las Cordobas, Llano, Quemado, Pilar, Ranchos, Talpa, and Valdez. Bullet point two is for unincorporated areas of Angel Fire, Cerro, Castilla, Condo Mesa, Pinasco, Ojo Caliente, plus the Red River, Taos, Ski Valley, and TP.
And how are they going to advertise the reduction rates for seniors and to help disabled? How are they going to get the word out?
My information from Waste Management is that they will include that information with their bill. And then your exhibit C and D are the forms that individuals can fill out and return to Waste Management to obtain those discounted services.
So they went up 4.10 CPI?
Commissioner Redondo, that's the consumer price index increased by 4%. So there are a number of things that go into their rates. Consumer price index is one of them. The cost of gas, the number of customers, labor lawsuits. It's a whole enchilada, but one of the factors that we brought forth to you all last year in updating this amendment was the ability to impact the rates in two ways with Waste Management. That if the CPI went up, Waste Management could increase their rates. If CPI went down, then we would also see that decrease. And then the second part of that would be the fuel surcharge that you're seeing. In years that fuel goes up, they can add that fuel surcharge, and years that go down, we can see that benefit on our rates. And so what we saw this year was that the CPI increased 4% and the fuel surcharge rate decreased 1%. Now those are one factor, about 100 in the actual rate that you see of $22 a month. But they are one of the things we worked hard on last year. The principle being that if the company is seeing an increase and is raising prices, that if due to economic factors, prices decrease, we should be able to pass that down onto our customers. And so that's what you're seeing in these adjustments.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, at some point, could the county manager find out how many customers we have in Penasco, both commercial and private? I'm curious to see how many are actually up there.
Mr. Chair, Commissioner O'Donnell, I'll get with Solid Waste and have them get those numbers to you and Mr. Mayor.
Thank you,
Commissioner. Mm-hmm.
You hear my stomach growl, and then you're talking a whole enchilada. I don't appreciate that. Mr. Cordova.
I just want to thank Ms. Robinson for fighting for the seniors and disabled. It was a little request that she made happen, and I appreciate that. I think it's very important for our citizens, especially because of the increase. So thank you, Ms. Robinson.
Thank you. I have a disabled senior mother, so I got into it a little bit with them, and it worked out.
Pleasure of the commission.
Did you accept the motion already, and then there was a
second? Oh, there was a discussion, that's correct.
Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner Fennell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Chairman Fennell?
Yes. All right. Thanks again, Cordova.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're on the next one, so just go ahead and stay there. Item C is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of Amendment 1 to the United States Forest Service Lease Agreement, TCC 2016-009. And you'll have Richard Sanchez helping if
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the commission. I don't believe Mr. Sanchez is trying to be nine places at once today, but the core of what I've been informed, and I know he did brief Mr. Harmonia, so he might be available for more detailed questions, is that the United States Forest Service has entered a lease with us last year to operate their dispatch center to use shared space here in our facility. The original move-in date was November 30th, and as you all are aware from fiscal issues locally and federally, they weren't able to meet that deadline to move in, so they requested that that be pushed back to up to March 31st. The latest information Richard gave me is that they believe they could be in the building in January. The purpose of this amendment is basic. The whole purpose of what a very long, complicated paragraph is basically, the core of it is that we're not going to charge the rent until they're actually here. So that would either be the date of what's called beneficial occupancy, either move-in date, or if they're not moved in by March 31st, at that point we would start charging them rent.
Move to approve.
I will second, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion and a second to approve Amendment 1 to the United States Forest Service Lease Agreement, TCC 2016-009.
With discussion. So we're charging them, but we're not going to charge the town if this tax passes the voters?
Chairman, Commissioner Donald, that's sort of outside the scope of my understanding or information at this point. This is just solely related to the agreement we signed last year to have the Forest Service
share our dispatch facility.
Mr. Chairman, since an election is coming up on the other issue, or if it's related, I think it's best if we don't discuss the substance.
In order noted, any other discussion?
When does this contract start? March 31st, and when does it end?
Basically, they're going to start being assessed once they move in.
So the term of the lease is for 5 years, started April 1st, 2016. The change that you're seeing related to is solely related to payment of rent. So in the meantime, the other features of the contract that have been moving forward in place is that the U.S. Forest Service was going to provide technological upgrades. I believe some sort of enhanced internet towers in preparation to move into our facility that they had upgrades to do, and they've been working on that. Mr. Sanchez could speak to that since April.
What's the yearly lease?
It's for 5 years.
And what's the amount?
For rent, it is a total sum of $29,990. Sorry, I'll let you.
it's right there, it's in our
pack. It's paragraph 3 of your lease agreement. It comes down to $29,991.60, which comes to about a total of about $20 per square foot.
Seems like this lease is a little premature given this proposed tax.
Chairman, Commissioner Donald, this was signed and approved by the State Board of Finance earlier this year. So the lease has been in effect. This is just an amendment.
This is a lease of space for the Forest Service to do their dispatch on our in our building. It has nothing to do with our dispatch operation. Any further discussion? Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Commissioner Blakenhorn.
Yes.
Chairman Fongo.
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, real quick, is there any more space available on that floor? This is it.
I'd have to defer to Mr. Manager or Brent for that.
This is it. This is it. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Item D is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding grant agreement for in DWI, buckle up, and 100 days of, I'm assuming we're going winter now instead of the 100 days of summer. This is a grant agreement for the Sheriff's Department. It will be presented by Amanda Rial, our grant. Thank you.
Commissioners, I am seeking approval today from you guys for the grant agreement for our Sheriff's Department. We received a grant agreement for our NDWI in the amount of $11,100, our Buckle Up program for $2,490, our 100 days in the amount of $3,000 for a total amount of funding of $16,590.
Move to approve.
I will second, Mr. Chairman.
Motion and a second to approve the grant agreement for NDWI Buckle Up in 100 days for our Sheriff's Department.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Commissioner Blakenhorn.
Yes.
Commissioner
Fetter. Yes. Thanks, Amanda.
Thank you.
Item E, discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of joint powers agreement with the National Joint Powers Alliance, NJPA, to become a participating member as per NMSA 13-1-135. Thanks for being patient and hanging out with us, Elsa.
No problem.
Nice of you to be here this morning. Ms. Vigil.
Chairman, Commission, before you, within your packet, is information in regards to the NJPA, or the National Joint Alliance, Joint Powers Alliance. And what it is a cooperative, and based on our state statute, any cooperative do require a joint powers agreement in order to use that procurement. This would open up many, many doors, not just for the county on the procurement side, but it would actually not hold us back anymore, because a procurement is really far behind. It's been really, really hard to procure parts and just projects in general. It's been a real task. So Taos County has never been a member of this alliance. It is at no cost, no obligation, and liability to the county. And basically it's done nationwide. It's done the national procurement process. So therefore we, based on this joint powers agreement, we utilize our laws in our state with the procurement to ensure we are following our community state statute.
I really appreciate you seeking out these price agreements. Not only are they time savers, but they're most often fund savers. I know in like HGAC and other things like that, they're just very valuable.
Thank you
for seeking this out.
Move to approve.
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion and a second to approve the joint powers agreement with National Joint Powers Alliance from a participating member of NMSA 13-1-135. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner Dunn?
Yes.
Commissioner Blakenhardt?
Yes.
Chairman Thambr?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks. Item F is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of TCC 2016-046, Amendment 1. This is with Robles, Rael, and Anaya regarding Randy Accio, our outside counsel for Taos County. Ms. Baker.
This is an amendment to the original contract of Robles, Rael. As you know, Randy Accio filled in between the previous county attorney's departure and my taking the job. And he's continuing to work on a few projects and also has helped us out in issues where we have a conflict of interest in the county attorney's office for various reasons. And for that reason, he has used the original $35,000, and now we wish to increase the contract up to $59,500 for the same term to cover any projects he's working on, any additional work through the end of the fiscal year, and it's just below $500 below the amount that would require us to go out for RFP, which is $60,000.
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve TCC 2016-46, Amendment 1, with Robles, Rael, and Aya. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner Dunn?
Yes.
Commissioner Blakenhardt?
Yes.
Chairman Thambr?
Yes. All right. Next, under resolutions and ordinances, item A for discussion only. This is the first reading of resolution 2016-56, a resolution recognizing and supporting the need for federal rule changes to reduce methane waste in oil and gas production. This is sponsored by Commissioner Gabriel Meadow.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The above resolution was emailed to me. I don't remember who it came from, but I believe it was an association with the New Mexico Association of, or a conjunction with the New Mexico Association of Counties, someone from the board. And so I submitted it for review by the County Commission. It is important to recognize a letter of support from a County Commissioner from San Miguel, County Commissioner District 1, Rock Ulibarri, who is an advisory member to ECHO, which is Hispanics enjoying camping, hunting, and the outdoors. Look forward to a favorable vote on that at a future date, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, when would you like to see this, Commissioner Romero?
I believe the beginning of the year would be really good.
We'll try to get it on the 10th.
If it's not too busy, then...
But if we read it and take time, if you have comments, give them to Commissioner Romero, Mr. Cordova, Mr. Jaramillo, between now and then for any changes that you see. If you need to share it with any of your constituents, if you would do that. We've got a couple of weeks now so we can get a good finished product. And thanks for bringing this to us, Commissioner Romero.
And Mr. Chairman, I recognize that this is not something that necessarily affects Taos County, but it does affect Rio Riva and Mora and San Miguel County.
It's always good to support our neighbors.
Yes, sir.
Any other discussion?
That's it. Thank you,
Mr. All right, we'll get this on the next. If you have, again, if you have comments, contact the powers that be between now and then. All right, item B is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of resolution 2016-60, a resolution proclaiming a special election on February 14, 2017 to consider whether Taos County should impose countywide emergency communication tax election. Ms. Robinson.
Thank you, Chairman and Commissioners. What you have before you is a follow-up item to last meeting commission voted to pass ordinance 2016-05 on the question of submitting a gross receipts tax in the amount of 0.1875% for the purposes of the countywide emergency communications gross receipts tax. The statute requires that a resolution be passed if the ordinance is adopted, and also a proclamation issued by the county clerk announcing the special election be held on February 14th, 2017. Commissioner Romero, you weren't present for the ordinance vote, so you can feel free to abstain if that feels appropriate to you. So this is resolution, and I can defer questions off the proclamation. I don't know if it's tradition for you to read your proclamations. Okay. to our clerk.
Okay.
I have a question. What's the amount we're proposing, and then will we be ever able to bring back an increase related to behavioral health?
Chairman, Commissioner, I'll have to defer to the county manager for that information.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, if we're going to do that, go back for the behavioral health, we start the process over. I thought that would be made that clear in the last meeting. Continue to move forward as it was.
So this is a perpetual tax, and we would never be able to come back and change the language in the tax, is what I'm wondering.
Not without going back to the voters, as I understand it. It would require the voters to make any changes going forward. However, there are other tax increments that would be available to us in the future that would allow us to, if the will of the commission is to do a behavioral health tax, there's other increments that we would be able to potentially use for those purposes.
Out of the same fund or out of the same?
There would be a different tax increment.
All right, thank you.
And Mr. Chairman, as far as me abstaining, what are your thoughts? Any further thoughts?
Not other than that, you know, you weren't present for the underlying, you may vote, but you weren't present for the underlying ordinance, the vote on the underlying ordinance, so I'll defer you, but it's appropriate for you to abstain if you feel that you need to.
Move to approve.
Second. We have a motion and a second to approve resolution 2016-60, a resolution proclaiming a special election and February 14, 2017, to consider whether Taos County should impose countywide emergency communication tax. Discussion.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I abstain, Commissioner O'Donnell has kind of indicated that she's going to vote against it. What can happen? Will that set us back? Any thoughts?
Chairman, Commissioner, would be like any other
resolution. So, three commissioners can vote on a resolution. It's needing four on a ordinance. Okay. Further discussion. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
No.
Commissioner Blakeman.
Yes.
Chairman Pepper.
Yes.
Thank you, Chairman Commissioners. I did want to let you know that Ms. Martinez, our clerk, will publish the proclamation in the Taos News. She'll be sending everybody those dates, and then the special election will be held on Valentine's Day. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next item is item C, discussion, consideration, and decision regarding the approval of resolution 2016-61, a resolution establishing legal holidays, operating hours for Taos County offices, and closing of county offices for calendar year 2017. Mr. Jaramillo, and I know that our county treasurer, newly re-elected county treasurer, has an amendment that she will be offering up on this as well. Mr. Jaramillo.
Chairman, members of the commission, stand before you to present this resolution, our annual holiday resolution. The Human Resources Department reviewed the resolution in conjunction with the collective bargaining agreement. The legal holidays were bargained for with the union, and this is the calendar that we have before you for adoption.
So we've gotten rid of Columbus Day, correct?
Correct. Us and the union negotiated for the term fault day.
I know you had a concern on that. Commissioner O'Donnell, are you okay with that?
Yes, I am. And it's nice that we can bring back possibly having a tribal cultural days for Taos people in Picardy's Pueblo at a later date, once we get buy-in from both Pueblos. I like that additional language that we can bring it back at any point to ask for half days for those feast days.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Romero, thank you very much. Does it cost the county more, say for example, like for New Year's Eve and Christmas Eve to open just half the day? Wouldn't it be cheaper to just?
It probably doesn't.
Does it not?
It probably a little bit cheaper to remain closed. I should say more cost effective or still more cheaper. However, we did look back at the union agreement, and these are the days we bargained for. So the union bargained for a day, Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. So, or the next closest day to Christmas. So for example, next Friday will be recognizing the 23rd as Christmas Eve, even though it fell on the weekend. And then the Christmas Day is taken as December 26th in this example. So there is language within the CBA that says the day of or the closest date to.
And commissioners, apparently, and help me, Susan, on this, there's language apparently that gives the other elected officials the right, if they need to close their office, being the clerk, the treasurer, and the assessor, for a given event, whereas closing books, things of that nature, all work-related, they can temporarily close their offices. That language was included with an asterisk before, but I believe it to be a statutory right to them to be able to do that. However, our treasurer would still like that language added back into this, Mr. Corbett.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, just to let you know why that was removed, it was just basically to try and create some consistency for our taxpayers so they know what our set hours are. We'll work with any of the electeds as they need to close their office. It wouldn't be a problem if it was a statutory obligation. There's no problem at all. But that was the goal. So if it is the will of the commission to put it back in, I think we can put it back in. The goal is just simply to have some consistency for the taxpayer.
Yeah, I mean, if Anna needed to close her office so the staff could catch up after an election or something, she certainly has that ability, as does Susan, as does everyone except for the sheriff. He's got to always be available, or Judge Shannon will toss him into the building straight in front of us.
That's okay with everybody. I'll move to approve.
To approve, get the sheriff thrown into that building, or... All right. Pleasure of the commission.
Move for approval of the resolution.
Okay.
As presented to us today, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion to approve Resolution 2016-62, resolution recognizing... That's 2016-61, resolution establishing legal holidays, operating hours for Taos County offices, and closing of calendar offices during the calendar year 2017.
Second.
And the second, clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Chairman Fairbanks?
Yes. Thank you all. Okay. Next item is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding Resolution 2016-62, resolution recognizing the value of national public lands to Taos County. We had
a... Chairman, sorry to interrupt. Madam Treasurer, with clarification on the vote, if it included the language that was amended.
The motion was to approve as was presented in the packet.
Can I make a comment, please?
Sure.
The language, good afternoon. Actually, it's good morning still. Chairman, members of the commission. The language that was previously on there for years was unless the elected official decides upon different hours. And I would like to say that this might most likely affect my office or the office of the treasurer even more so in that the treasurer's office closes
at 2 o'clock p.m. at the end of every month, at 12 o'clock at the end of the fiscal year. We have adjusted our staff meetings to whenever they're absolutely needed and for a minimum of time, and when it's absolutely necessary. We had a training this last week with a safety committee, and we remained open, but it was so disruptive to them to present. And the meeting with an open environment, because we were still getting people, but they wanted to have the training done. And so it's like, we use a lot of discretion as, you know, when we do open and close our office. And and again, when we're short staffed, we have to close the meeting. There should always be three people in the cashiers on the floor to remain open. So a lot, right now, we have someone on vacation, and we have someone to call in if their child being sick. But we still have three, so we will remain open. But we never know if there's only two. We have to close down at noon so that they can have their lunch. So we work with a skeleton crew, and again, the time will tell. But we want to be able to say, well, we're going to close at noon because of these issues. And again, sometimes we want to have a holiday luncheon out of the office. And we'd like to have that discretion. And it was afforded to us before. When the county announces a closure, we need to be notified in order to close our office 1 hour prior to balancing. That, again, if they close at, let's say, 3 o'clock because of the inclement weather, we need to know that we can close at 2 o'clock for balancing purposes. This last week when the county was given the administrative leave, lunch was going to be served here at the commission chambers, we opted to close at 12 o'clock. We still had to balance and then come at 1 o'clock to have lunch with everybody else and then leave accordingly at 2 o'clock. So we have to make those provisions have to be afforded to us so that we can comply with everything and close and have enough time to do everything that is required of us. And and again, the office closure should be left to the discretion of the elected official. And again, I think the managers would like, and I think in our communication, that the treasurer's office will notify all the other county offices of these closures when they occur. And it's common courtesy so that they, if someone is, let's say we have to close at noon, and you know, we'll alert everyone that we're going to be closed so that if someone comes down and they don't know that we've closed, that at least they'll say they're just closed for lunch. And so I would really, really appreciate if you reconsider and leave that language in there for the sake of the elected offices and their.
Mr. Chairman,
thank you.
We've already decided the matter and by vote. So we thank you for your comments. So I think you saw the right. You just run past the manager, and you know, but we need to be here for the public.
Well, exactly.
First and foremost.
And that is exactly my point, is that they are the ones that are.
Closing eliminates time for the public, especially now that the tax bills are being paid. I don't think closing now is a good idea.
Well, we're not closing now, but I'm saying this is.
Gave great examples of things that are going on now for safety meetings and stuff.
Well, we didn't close. Like I said, we didn't
close.
Mr. Chairman, I just kind of wondering, we can't make that decision today, but if Ms. Baker could maybe advise us how we could proceed with this at a future date if we would want to do that.
I think there's a way we could reopen it at our next scheduled meeting, but I'd like the opportunity to meet and discuss state statute and some of the protections in the state statute. So why don't we work as staff with Susan, and then if she feels the need, you could reopen this by motion at the next meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Susan. Okay, as previously stated, this is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding Resolution 2016-62, a resolution recognizing the value of national public lands to Taos County. This is the same resolution that I presented to you at the last meeting,
with the exception of the, because of a concern that Commissioner O'Donnell brought forward, we added the last whereas these lands are an outstanding value to surrounding villages, tribal groups, and safety organizations, land grant communities, and nothing in this resolution will diminish their rights. That's the only change in this as was presented, and we had a lengthy discussion last meeting.
Make a motion to approve. Chairman, thank you for bringing this to us.
I'll go ahead and second, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion to approve Resolution 2016-62, Resolution Recognizing Value of National Public Lands, UNM-Taos County.
With discussion.
Discussion, Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I stated in a previous meeting, the land grant people in Santa Barbara and Trompas do not support this. At a recent land grant council meeting held tonight in Las Cruces, it was reiterated that even though this language has been added, it's still the final paragraph contradicts it. But it is based on 2014 New Mexico Statute 49, which allows land grants the rights, many rights, including purchasing back land grants from Forest Service, and also in the New Mexico Constitution under the Section 5, Article 2, Section 5, the rights under the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo preserved. That is my issue. I think when we had a meeting with Congressman Lujan yesterday, he did say the new secretary supports keeping public lands. It's highly unlikely the Republicans are going to get their wish to allow the states to get back public land. So I kind of feel that, you know, it was maybe a knee-jerk reaction to the new administration. And I did have a question for Mr. Olivas relating to their land grant. Do you fall under the state statute 49, and did you purchase your model land grant at some point?
Mr. Olivas, if you'll state your name for the
record. Yeah, my name is John Olivas. I am a heir to the Mora land grant, as Commissioner O'Donnell is requesting some information on that. Well, the Mora land grant is a land grant that has been certified by the Secretary of State as a what's the term that we use?
Registered.
Well, we're a registered land grant. There's a legal entity under the state of New Mexico, so we have the authority within the Mora land grant to go after Catalate funds. As many land grants across the state of New Mexico do as well. So we do fall under that same authority. And we also have a resolution by the Mora land grant that supports the expansion of the Pecos wilderness as well. So our heirs and our land grant board understand kind of the ramifications behind that, understand that the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo exists out there, and that the treaty rights under the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo allow the use rights, and I think that was important within that resolution that those items remained in there. So,
Do you have your expansion includes the Mulvaney land grant?
Yes.
The Pecos Wilderness?
Yes. Uh-huh.
All right, thank you. Well, nevertheless, you know my vote, so thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
No.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Chairman Fowler?
Yes. All right, thank you very much. Again, as a reminder, anyone that came in late, we did have a public hearing regarding an ordinance. That ordinance was moved up in the agenda to accommodate the time that was advertised, and that has been continued to 10 a.m. on January 10th, 2017.
Moving on to item 11A is discussion under department matters, is discussion, consideration, and approval of a job description for a healthcare advocate specialist case manager for the healthcare assistance program. This will be presented by our indigent fund coordinator, Ms. Tammy Cunningham. Morning.
Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. I stand here today for approval of a case manager position in the healthcare assistance program. The title of the position is healthcare advocate specialist. It is equivalent to a re-entry specialist job description. I want to note, in creating this position, I have worked with the detention center, with honorable magistrate judges and a district judge, and providers that are currently working with the pretrial services, and also have spoken to some detainees on what do they believe causes them to return to the detention center. And at that, that's how we came up with this job description, putting all those components together. And so I ask for approval. I stand for questions.
Judge Shannon, would you like to, I assume this is why you're here?
I was supposed to be here.
Or you just lost the flip and had to come to the meeting?
Well, I was last minute, but I'm here. Or we'll take us out six, so I'm here to talk if you have any questions for me.
Okay. Commissioner O'Donnell.
I think this is excellent. So my only question is, we've heard about a transportation component to help people get to where they need to be. I don't see this in the job description. Could you explain how you're going to address that issue of transportation?
Chairman, Commissioner, that's not in the job description. That's another component that we'll have to work on. But getting this started and the pre-trial, it is essential at this point. So that should probably be in another phase. And also talking to district judge he would also like to see the risk assessment done as well, so that would probably be phased in as well later on. But we definitely want to work in the pre-trial considering the cutbacks.
So, Mr. Chairman, it may be that in the future we might have a part-time transportation person, because this is a more highly qualified position. So maybe in the future we could address that. Is that?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, yes, I think there are other options for transportation. I think the RTD is trying to work on that. I think even our senior program may potentially give us some options at transportation, and this position would be more of a coordinator of that with the other options that are already available to us. So the other thing I wanted to mention was the letter I handed out to the commission in support of this position from Judge McElroy. I had the opportunity to sit down with Judge Shannon as well regarding the DWI programs and get a better understanding from him and that side of the world, in the sense of what they need from us. They're experiencing some major budget cuts at the state level, and the concern is how do we keep up with the important programs that they're providing, that we're providing, and how do we continue that support. And so this is one step to try and do that, to try and help them with pretrial services. We're also looking very comprehensively at the DWI program, and it probably will require us funding some of those positions out of the general fund to make sure that we can continue to help with the compliance component that's necessary for the courts.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to hear from Judge Shannon, with your permission, if he would like to say anything.
Sure, absolutely, anytime.
A couple of years ago, the state Supreme Court came out with a case called State v. Brown. And State v. Brown dealt with release from custody. And the man was charged with premeditated first-degree murder. And he spent a couple of years in jail. And the defense went up to the court in Albuquerque like a third time and said, let's let this man out of jail. And they gave all these reasons. We've got pretrial services in place, we've got everything in place, and we're good to go. And the prosecutor's response was essentially premeditated first-degree murder. And the judge agreed. And bond was left at $500,000. The state Supreme Court said no. He's not been convicted of a crime yet. And absent a finding of dangerousness or flight risk, and you cannot use the charge itself to determine dangerousness, he had to be released. So the judge, the Supreme Court ordered this man accused of premeditated first-degree murder to be released in custody. We have a new constitutional amendment that just passed. That's going to give the court some greater authority to keep people that were believed to be dangerous or flight risk in custody. Because right now there are only two exceptions in the Constitution, and most of the time they didn't apply. My court, in terms of setting release on somebody, is governed by Rule 6401B. Amongst the factors I have to consider are flight risk and criminal history, things like that I can find out myself. But I also have to consider other issues, mental health issues, issues of substance abuse, be it alcohol or drugs or prescription medication. That's a problem. I have a person who's got a history who might otherwise be released, but I have major questions to ask before I release them. Because if I do release them, I have to know under what conditions or rules they're released. So we leave them in jail. And so you need a screening and assessment for drugs or alcohol or mental health prior to your release. Because I have to establish that they're not a flight risk and that they're not a danger if I've got an inkling that they might be. How much a day for the jail? 60, 70 bucks a day. And we've had problems in the past because we get it done and it might take some time. We're trying to coordinate to get these things done quickly. But the sooner that this can be done, the sooner that they can see a judge with the information necessary for the judge to make an informed decision, which is why this is important. Because the Supreme Court says you got to let them out unless you've got good reason to keep them in.
I think
these assessments will either give you the reasons to let them out under what conditions or the information I need to say no, they perhaps will stay in jail a lot longer. So we need this information. And I, as the judge, do not have the means or actually the authority to get that involved with somebody in the interviews and doing right. That's got to be a third person. I have to step back and let the experts make certain decisions. And I'll say the last thing about a case manager and what it means. A couple of years ago, a state police officer, a rookie, got a warrant signed by a district judge and then filed a criminal complaint in district court. The process is almost always filed in magistrate court first. In the magistrate court, judges, Judge O'Kagan and myself, check the jail log every day. I saw some emails this weekend. Well, I had called the jail and they sent me one about 8:30 in the morning. So I had the jail log I was looking at Saturday. And I do this religiously. I did it this morning, even my opening. I was in jail as a senior judge. I need somebody, though, at the jail. Because we have the situation where this case got filed in district court. When I look at the jail log, I look at who's got a mag court case. Magistrate. I'm paying attention. District court, not my problem. This person had the case filed, spent about a month in jail without seeing a judge because no one was seeing his name on the jail log because it was listed in their district court. And district court does not do arraignments and things on new cases. Rarely a month in jail. A caseworker would catch this. A caseworker would say, oops, this guy hasn't seen a judge yet. He's been in jail for 3 or 4 days. Let's find out what's going on. Why is this person here? Why have they not seen a judge? What do we need to make sure that this person is getting the attention they deserve? I think it was 2 or 3 years ago, a man was in Doniahan County Jail for 9 months. He got lost in the system. This man spent 30 days in the state police. Eduardo realized the mistake that they made, came in right away and fixed it. And thank God Eduardo Martinez came in and fixed that mistake, or the man might still be in jail. A caseworker would be able to identify this and say, this person needs to see a judge now. This case is in district court. Why is he not seeing a judge? And it should save the county some immediate expense on custody and perhaps a long-term expense in case of Doniahan County type mistake happens or another type of incident which happened a couple of years ago. So having a face in the jail, talking to people, coordinating, and letting us know what's going on can be huge. It can be very huge. And would be a huge help to us in expediting the release of people that should otherwise not be in custody. Any questions?
Thank you, Judge Shannon.
Thank you.
Another reason to believe him, not just because he's a judge, he's also a cut silence. We can always add that to the resume. Anything else, commissioners?
Commissioner O'Donnell, would you like to make a motion?
Yes, I would. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I so move that we approve the job description for healthcare advocate specialist case manager for the healthcare assistance program.
I'll go ahead and second, Mr. Chairman, and just wanted to make sure that the letter of support by Judge McElroy is going to be entered for the record.
Absolutely, we'll give one to the clerk. So I have a motion and a second to approve the job description for a healthcare advocate specialist case manager for the healthcare assistance program with the support letter from Judge McElroy. Further discussion? Hearing none, clerk call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blackman?
Yes.
Chairman Feigl?
Yes. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Get her hired. Ken Hurd.
Morgan.
Then those. Item 11B under Department Matters is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of purchase of a metal building from Olympia Steel Buildings for the Rio Fernando Fire Department. This is their station that, when we first came onto the commissioner, that we settled the land stuff, and so now we're to that point of getting the building. Ms. Vigil.
Hi.
Chairman,
Commission. I'm here presenting on behalf of Mike Cordova today. I was going to have Richard, but of course, like Cueva said, he had me in my thesis at once. So this particular metal building is a 4,000 square foot building, 4-bay, for the Rio Fernando Volunteer Fire Department. Attached to your packet shows the three quotes. The other two quotations acquired obviously were a lot higher, but also did not meet the prior station requirements based on specifications and plans that we need for those particular buildings. Olympia Steel is also the same manufacturer that we use for the San Cristobal Fire Department, and our goal is to make all fire stations uniform with the benefits for Taos County for maintenance and any future alterations. Before you today, I'm asking approval for the purchase of this building in the amount of $54,999.
Commissioner O'Donnell, would you like to make a motion?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I so move that we approve purchase of a metal building from Olympia Steel Buildings for the Rio Fernando Volunteer Fire Department.
I have a motion to approve the purchase of a metal building from Olympia Steel Buildings for the Rio Fernando Fire District.
I'll go ahead and second, Mr. Chairman.
And a second. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenher?
Yes.
Chairman Feigl?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman? Oh, I'm so sorry.
Go ahead.
The building that was there, the portable building, has it been moved? Are you going to tear it down? What's going to happen to that building?
Mr. Cordova. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, we are preparing to move it, and our intention is to park it out in the old armory and remodel it and use it for office spaces out there.
Very good.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to item 12, budget matters. Item A is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of DFA resolution number 13 for 2016-17 fiscal year, resolution requesting to renumber Taos County's internal funds to establish consistency with DFA reporting requirements. Ms. Martinez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Previous administration used to utilize the 221 for debt service funds. At the last commission meeting, we approved 221 to use for the county hospital, which is the required DFA number used for that. So we're just asking to renumber internal fund numbers, and I have attached all the budgets, there's three of them, for debt service for the complex, the lodgers, and the fire excise tax, and I recommend approval.
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve DFA resolution number 13 for 2016-17 fiscal year, resolution requesting to renumber Taos County's internal funds to establish consistency with DFA reporting. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenher?
Yes.
Chairman Feigl?
Yes. Item B is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of DFA resolution number 14 for 2016-17 fiscal year, resolution requesting to adjust the 2017 fiscal year final budget to account for amendment number one, increasing Taos County Senior Program by the amount of $24,401.22 budget cuts. Ms. Martinez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. DFA resolution number 14 establishes the decrease that we received for the senior program in the amount of $24,401. The two components that will be affected from this cut are transportation and respite care. We've made accommodations to satisfy the rest of the budget for the other other components, but I do recommend approval on this, considering the next agenda item is we receive another grant for $40,000 for the council.
So it'll make it up?
Yeah.
Okay, move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner Romero, for your motion to approve DFA Resolution Number 14 for 2016-17 fiscal year resolution requesting to adjust the 2017 fiscal year final budget to account for Amendment Number 1 decreasing senior program by $24,401. Do I hear a second?
Second.
And a second. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner Bell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Yes. And as previously mentioned, item C is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of DFA Resolution Number 15 for 2016-17 fiscal year resolution requesting to adjust the 2017 fiscal year final budget to establish a fund and budget account for a grant received by the Daniels Fund in the amount of $40,000 to assist with Meals on Wheels program. Ms. Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, DFA number 15 is as a result of our executive director of the senior program and our grant accountant to apply for various grants that are afforded to our seniors. They did apply and receive $40,000 from the Daniels Fund, and this request is to establish the fund and budget to administer the account and the amount for Taos County for the fiscal year 2016-2017, and
great.
I do recommend approval.
Great news, and just recognizing you and the rest of the grant staff for this great work. And, you know, they're doing a good thing with the senior citizens program. I just wish we could help some more later on in the future because we
should have that
assistance. Yeah. So move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve DFA resolution number 15 for 2016-17 fiscal year resolution requesting to adjust the 2017 fiscal year final budget to establish a fund and budget account for a grant received from the Daniels Fund in the amount of $40,000 to assist with Meals on Wheels. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Chairman Pepper?
Yes. Item D is discussion, consideration, and decision regarding approval of DFA Resolution Number 16 for 2016-17 fiscal year resolution requesting to adjust the 2017 fiscal year final budget to establish a fund and budget account for DFA capital appropriations project number 16-82519 in the amount of $100,000 for the Northern Mexico Library and Acequia Archives building. Ms. Martinez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, DFA number 16 was established at the request of one of our lead persons who's taking on this project. He's from UNM-Taos. His name is Luis Moya. He's contacted Taos County to establish a budget so he can do the water archiving that's needed for the historical preservation of some documents that they do have in hand. So this DFA resolution establishes a fund and budget, and I'm also asking for a temporary loan in the amount of $100,000. Keep in mind that this will only be transferred upon need, so the grants accounted as they administer the fund. If there's expenses, we'll ask for documents to transfer the entire amount, but this does come with a transfer of cash in the amount of $100,000 from our general fund.
This is pass-through money from a project from Senator Cisneros that he contacted us through to get the funding for UNM to do this. It'll be in the building where municipal court is held on Civic Plaza Drive.
Move to approve. I'll go ahead and second, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion and a second to approve DFA Resolution Number 16 for 2016-17 fiscal year resolution requesting to adjust the 2017 fiscal year final budget to establish a fund and budget to account for DFA capital appropriations project number 16-82519 in the amount of $100,000 for the Northern Mexico Land Grant and Acequia Archives. Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Chairman Pepper?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a Merry Christmas. We don't see you. Item 13 is County Manager's Report and Matters, update to the County Commission on various items that are affecting Taos County. Mr. Corva.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I don't have a whole
lot to do.
I'll try and get you out of here and get you guys to eat some lunch, but I did want to mention that we're back on track with our BLM permit for the pit in southern Taos County near between Roscoe and Dixon. I want to thank Mr. Jaramillo and Mr. Pacheco for getting that back on track. I do think we will start the clock on January 1st on that. We'll have a three-year agreement, and we can actually start pulling product out of there in March. So So I just wanted to alert the commission of that good news. As a manager, I've been working with all our department heads, meeting on the SWOT analysis so that we can continue to prepare for the retreat. We've finalized the date and the location, SMU campus on January 5th, and I'm still putting a lot of work into a state of a county type of presentation for you and meeting with every department head to talk about their SWOTs and kind of focusing more on the threats and the weaknesses. That seems to be what we have in common as department heads, and I want to thank the elected officials for working with Mr. Cordova on their analysis. So. Yesterday was the ceremony for the Taos Feast House. Chairman Fambro, Commissioner O'Donnell were present, and I want to thank all our elected officials that helped, but I also very much want to thank all the employees that were able to volunteer. It's a great event. It's always so touching to see the total number of people that are served, and it hits every corner of our county, and it's so much appreciated. So I just wanted to thank our employees for their volunteer time. And one last thing, and this is some really good news. We are one place that Mr. Sanchez was at today of his nine was that he had to head to Changsar so that we can work on the certificate of completion for the Changsar transfer site. We do plan to reopen that next week. So I want to thank everyone that has worked really hard on that project, and we're excited to get that open for the citizens of Southern Taos County, especially right after Christmas, and I'm sure there's going to be a lot of waste for them to dispose of. That's all I have to report on today. I stand for any questions or concerns of me.
Commissioners? Okay, thank you, Mr. Cordova.
Thank you.
Next item is item 14, Commissioners' Reports and Matters. Item A is any new business to be considered a future meeting. Hearing none, Commissioners' Announcements. Commissioner O'Donnell.
I just wanted to remind the commission that January 18th is the Enchanted Circle Day right at the legislature, and we've asked to have a booth there at the rotunda. And is that going to happen?
First I've heard of it.
Yeah, it's the first we've heard of the Enchanted Circle Day. We will do our best to get a booth there, certainly.
Okay, I think I did bring it up a few months ago. It was brought up at the IGC meeting 2 or 3 months ago, and you could mark that on the calendar to get someone there to man a booth with our Taos County highlights. You know, what I've seen done in the past is a lot of these counties put out little brochures to promote their business, and they actually leave it at the table at the rotunda. I'm not suggesting we have time to do that now, but whatever we could, to whatever kind of booth we could set up that would showcase what we have to offer. I think it's important. It is an all-day event, so somebody would have to be down there all day to man that booth. Just a reminder about that one.
Mr. Chairman, maybe what we can do is talk a little bit about the fact that we're hosting the annual NMAC conference in June at the legislature. We'll target a few people there.
Certainly will.
Also, Mr. Chairman, if I may, keep in prayers Socorro County Commissioner and Valencia County Manager Danny Monet. His wife, Maurice, passed away on Friday suddenly. So if you can keep her in your prayers, we really appreciate that. The family wish.
Thank you, Commissioner. Tommy?
No, Chairman. Thank
you. Husky?
Oh.
It's getting there.
Mr. Chairman,
I
believe Representative Gonzalez will be at the IGC meeting tomorrow, is that correct, to talk about legislative priorities, and is that 10 o'clock here?
Yes.
Or do you have you change your landfill meeting, so it is here at 10?
10 o'clock here, and Representative Gonzalez will be here, so good point, thank you.
Does Anissa know so she can set up for it?
A little late for that. Yeah. That's probably my bad. I didn't get that. I wanted him all for myself. So.
You can do that.
But well,
you have the commissioner can certainly show up.
Yeah.
The
best. Yeah, I've got
we you should notice that if we can still.
If you want.
Oh. Okay. You too?
She'll be here.
Are you going?
And Mark may be here on, you know, he's just really busy with the
the water stuff. They're trying to get their permit today, Brent, I believe. He's in front of the Environment Department as we speak, trying to get water to the citizens up there. We give him our best. It's very sad. I've seen that the Village of Quester go through one other water issue in the middle of summer. That one occurred on January 3rd and went for 39 plus days. And it's just unfortunate those people are enduring what they are. We give the Village of Quester our best. Bobby Lucero has been helping a lot. Dominic's been helping a lot. We'll just keep doing anything we can. All right. Next item is item 15, adjournment.
So moved.
A motion and a second to adjourn. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That was poor and affirmative. I saw. Thank you very much, Francis. Thank you, Fairly. Merry Christmas.